Okay, so the MCU Phase 3. So welcome to Enchantment of Eternity's review of the MCU Phase 3 Part 1. In this video, I will be covering the first 6 movies of the MCU, which apparently they refer to as Phase 3. So, if this video is part of a series of videos where I'm covering every movie of the MCU, so if you haven't seen the first 2 videos, I'd recommend checking them out first. But basically, the format that I'm doing is the same, where I talk about my thoughts of what I remember about the movie when I saw it all those years ago. And then I go watch the movie, and then I come back and give you my thoughts fresh after just rewatching it and see if they line up with what I remember about it. But now we're getting into Phase 3, which came out a bit more recent. So obviously my pre-thoughts of what I remember about it is going to be a lot closer to how I feel after actually I saw it, because these movies I've actually seen pretty recently. Most of them I saw when they first came out in the theaters, which was only a couple years ago. So getting into Phase 3, this is, from my personal experience, this is when I started really getting into the MCU, because as I mentioned, you know, arguably I'm not that crazy into it. I'm not, some people are like, they think it's the best thing ever and they're huge fanboys and it consumes their life, where I never got to that point because I'm more of a fan of Star Trek, The Expanse, used to be Game of Thrones, and that used to be good, and stuff like that. But I do really much enjoy the MCU, and I talked about in my earlier videos of Phase 1 in particular, where I didn't care about the MCU at all, and I barely paid any attention to it, and it wasn't until Phase 2 that I actually started to get into it a bit. But by the time we get into Phase 3 is when I'm pretty well devoted to it. Again, not an obsessed fanboy, but still pretty devoted to going out and seeing every movie, which is the difference, because I talked about in the Phase 1 how most of the movies I actually just rented on DVD years or months after it came out and just played video games and paid half attention to it. Whereas we're entering the stage now where every single one of these movies I went out and saw it in the theaters when it first came out, from here on out. In fact, it actually started a bit earlier with Guardians of the Galaxy in Phase 2. So Guardians of the Galaxy, Avengers Age of Ultron, and Ant-Man are all saw in the theaters. So it actually starts with Guardians of the Galaxy. From there on out, every single one of these movies I saw in the theaters when it first came out. So I was a bit more invested. And it was around this time that I was really, and I'm still to this day actually, really obsessed with watching a lot of these online news YouTube channels like Screen Junkies and Collider and stuff like that. And even though I'm not that big into comic book movies, I don't know, I just like watching those channels anyway, but they're obsessed with comic book movies, so it kind of seeped into me and gets me a bit more excited about, you know, particularly the MCU, because that's all they fucking talk about. Even though I'm more interested in other stuff, like Star Trek, Game of Thrones, whatever, it's still, I don't know, I still liked watching those channels for some reason. And so that watching those channels got me more excited for the MCU. So by we get to this Phase 3, I'm a bit more sort of locked in and actually watching the trailers and actively anticipating these movies, which is different even from Guardians of the Galaxy, Age of Ultron, and Ant-Man, which I wasn't, I did see all those in the movie theaters, but I wasn't actually actively anticipating these movies and watching the trailers and be like, oh boy, I can't wait for that movie. That began here in Phase 3, and with the very first movie, which I'll get to shortly, and it continues onward all the way throughout the rest of Phase 3. Now, as I mentioned, this is part 1 of my coverage of Phase 3, because Phase 1 and 2 each had 6 movies, but Phase 3, for some reason, has 11 movies. So that's too much to do in one video. Splitting it up, doing 6 movies in this video and 5 movies in the next video, so each video has pretty much an equal number of movies. I don't know. Personally, I think why didn't they just call it Phase 4 for the second part when we started with Infinity War, because it feels like a different phase. But even if they did that, why didn't they just end Phase 3 after Endgame? That seems like the proper thing to do. But I think it's because Sony, they wanted to do that because they wanted to have a year gap between Phase 3 and 4, but Sony didn't want to wait to do Spider-Man. They're like, now fuck you, Marvel. We want to make money now. So they're like, all right, fine. I guess it makes no sense to say that Phase 3 ends and Phase 4 starts like 3 months apart. We want a huge break in between the phases, so let's just call Far From Home part of Phase 3. But anyway, I guess I'll talk more about that in the next video. So I think this is when I talked about Phase 1, which are like your classic sort of, is when they're first establishing the universe, and a lot of the movies felt more like your typical comic book movies, whereas Phase 2, they started to spread out more, which is why I think the MCU endured, by the way, because they start to get away from your stereotypical comic book movies, even though all the movies arguably still had elements of your superhero comic book movies. They started drifting more into separate genres, like Winter Soldier got into the whole espionage, political thriller, Ant-Man was more of a heist comedy film, and Guardians of the Galaxy is more of a space opera, so that sort of thing. And this definitely continues onward through Phase 3, where I would argue the movies got even more unique, even though some of them still do rely on the typical comic book tropes. Anyway, I think that's enough preamble. Let me now get into more preamble, but more specifically for the first movie of Phase 3. And that is Captain America Civil War. Now, I did actually do a review on this movie on my YouTube channel when it first came out, so you can check that out if you haven't seen it. Most people who are, you know, follow my channel regularly very much know my feelings on this movie and that they differ from popular opinion greatly. I will say that I was very highly anticipating this movie when it first came out. This is probably one of the movies in the MCU I was most looking forward to out of any movie, and perhaps that's what set me up for disappointment, because my expectations were way too high. Much higher than, like Hasse said, any previous MCU movie, my expectations were never that high. Here, because I loved Winter Soldier so much, and I still love it, and I still think it's an amazing film. I actually liked it even better on the rewatch. And I knew that this was, not only was this the next Captain America movie, but it was done by the same creative team that did Winter Soldier. So it's really hyped, and I saw the trailers that had Iron Man versus Captain America. I'm like, wow, this looks fucking awesome. You know, it should be noted, this came out around the same time, maybe a month or two after Batman v Superman, which I had zero interest in. Like, a lot of people were like pissed off that it was Batfleck. I didn't give a fuck. I don't care who the fuck plays Batman. I was just really pissed off at the fact that they're doing a Batman v Superman movie before they fucking even introduced Batman. They didn't introduce Batman. The DCEU was still young. They still needed time to establish it. But now let's jump straight into fan service. And it was the complete jumbled mess that I knew it would be. So I had zero interest for that. But I was interested in this, Civil War. Who gives a fuck about Batman v Superman? I want to see Iron Man v Captain America. That looks amazing, because I know it's done. The MCU has established most of these characters. I know who they are. And they did such a great job in the previous movie, Winter Soldier, that it's going to be amazing. That's just a given. And watching the reviews and channels like Screen Junkies, which were like having orgasms all over this film, and everyone saying it was the best film ever, and a lot of critics and reviewers and comic book fans will still say that this is one of the best movies the MCU ever put out, and it was just simply amazing. So I was like, oh my god, it is gonna be good. So I went in the movie theater, and I talked about how I don't like people who talk at movie theaters or who yell things. I think it's, generally speaking, I mean, there are exceptions to every rule, but generally speaking, it's annoying and rude, and I would never, I always never try to do that myself. This is the one time The one time where I had a very loud vocal outburst was when I saw this movie in the theater. And that's when they had the reveal that Zemo had, like, set everything up so that, like, the Winter Soldier thing was just a red herring. That had nothing to do with anything. He just set this up in order to get Captain America and Iron Man to fight. And when they revealed that, I was like, I couldn't help myself. And then the movie there, I was like, oh, come on! I was just like, that's so stupid! And this is what I think about. This movie, by the way, made me really lower my opinion of the Russo brothers. And I think a lot of the issues, maybe not to the degree this movie had, but a lot of the issues the Russo brothers had with not being able to keep characters in character, have them act out of characters, have them act in stupid ways that is inconsistent and doesn't make sense, and have plots that are all really twist up and convoluted. They carry all this on into an Infinity War. Thankfully, they sort of rein themselves in for Endgame, which I loved, but I'll get to that later. Infinity War, I also had a lot of issues with. Now, with Civil War, anyone who is familiar with my channel knows, I think this is one of the most convoluted movies I've ever seen. That the plot is so, like, convoluted and twisted and contrived and unbelievable, unnatural. I do not buy for a second that Zemo was able to plan this step by step by step by step by step by step plan. I remember Screen Junkies did a video about this, to their credit, because they did, most of the people at Screen Junkies, as I said, they went ape shit over this movie, thought it was the best thing ever. But there was one guy, Lon Harris, who I gave him, paid tons of respect to. He did a video about how Zemo's plot makes no sense and how horrible and convoluted it was. And the comment section was just loaded with fanboys being like, oh, you're wrong, you don't understand, no, it makes sense, oh, you're wrong, blah, 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 blah. And I hate that. That makes me sad. That makes me cry for humanity that you have a lot of fanboys defending this obvious convoluted piece of shit plot that is so horribly written and makes no sense. I'm sorry. You know, in the past, like I told you, I did my review of this movie when it first came out, and I gave it a 7 out of 10 because there are things about this movie I like. I like the airport fight. I like, you know, seeing the conflict between Captain America and Iron Man. I like Steve Rogers' personal character story in this film. But I don't know. I think whenever I think about this movie in retrospect, I think I was being way too kind to it by giving a 7, because even though there are good things about it, I think the flaws far away. I mean, not only is it makes me want to cry for all humanity when I hear some people say that Zemo is one of the best villains of the MCU. He's easily the worst. And I heard that he's returning for Phase 4. Kill me now. He's easily the worst. Easily the worst. I should do like a ranking of all the villains from worst to best. And Zemo's easily at the bottom of the list. He's easily the worst. He's worse than Malekith. And Malekith was just boring. Or Malachi, whatever the fuck his name is, who's in Dark World. His only sin was being boring. This guy is outright inconceivable, and the plot he comes up with is so convoluted and I don't buy him. That's a worse sin than being. He's unrealistic. I don't like him. He's not flawed. He's horribly written. It's much worse than just being boring. And so it's not just that, though. It's also, as I said, a lot of the characters act out of character, particularly Tony Stark and Iron Man. Like, I'm sure I'll save this till after I watch the film, but the way he reacts and tries to kill the Winter Soldier because the Winter Soldier killed his parents, even though he intellectually knows that the Winter Soldier was just a tool who's brainwashed by Hydra, and the Hydra's the ones responsible for killing his parents. He was just the fucking tool. It's like you found out there was a Russian conspiracy to kill your father, and they used a gun to shoot your father in the face, and so you make it your life's mission to find that that specific gun, and I'm not talking about gun control, I'm talking about you find that specific gun that they use, not just the type of gun, but that very specific gun, and you go, fuck you, gun! That's the equivalent of what Tony Stark does by trying to kill the Winter Soldier. I'm sorry, but it is. And it's stupid. It is so stupid. Anyway, let me go watch this film. I'm very curious to see if my opinion will go up or down from that 7 I gave it when I first saw it. We'll see. I'll come back here and report on that. All right, Captain America Civil War. So, I watched this film again, and you know what? For most of the film, I would say, I was really digging it. And I was thinking, wow, maybe I'm wrong. I was wrong all these years to be all hard on this film. I don't understand, actually, why I don't like this film. Because this film's actually really good. Like, throughout the majority of it. I mean, you got to start with the fight with Crossbones, which I thought was pretty intense. I liked the chemistry between the characters and the quippiness. It was always fun. And then it ended in, like, a tragedy where Wanda was trying to save the day, but she ended up killing a bunch of people and how that weighed heavily on her. And then the Sokovia Accords came. And then the Sokovia Accords played on all the characters, like how they've been established so well, because they all had different reactions. Like, Wanda, of course, was still like heartstruck by the tragedy that she caused, and she blames herself, and it doesn't help that the news and everyone else blames her as well. And it does kind of make sense that you would have the government sort of overreact and try to put these accords on them, and it makes sense that Tony Stark, of course, would be totally on board with it. This is actually watching the MCU in order, I noticed that this is well established in his character to feel guilty over things that he did. And this is actually a major component to his character that they portrayed. Of course, his guilt always leads him to do things that actually make things worse, such as creating Ultron. And now he's just off at it again, supporting these accords. And so, and Captain America, of course, is very against it, and because it makes sense for his character, because he brings up how S.H.I.E.L.D. was corrupted by Hydra, and so if they put the Avengers' power in government, committees that also are subject to corruption, then they could end up being controlled by an entity just as evil as Hydra. And I think he makes a really great point. And then he goes to Peggy Carter's funeral, which is very tragic, and it's continuing that storyline in a really good way. And then he has, I think it's a bit silly, though, that the person who was in Winter Soldier was, like, watching him in the next room, that all of a sudden she's Peggy's niece or whatever, and he makes out with her. That was a bit weird, but she says a speech at the funeral saying that how Peggy would stick to her principles regardless, and she'd be a stone or rock and refusing to move if she knew it was the right thing to do. And that was a really good build up to, and you could tell how that affected Steve Rogers, and I think that made a lot of sense. And so that made a lot of sense for things going forward. And then you had that fight scene that we got with, and then of course, Black Panther's father was killed, and he blamed Winter Soldier, and Steve Rogers wanted to protect the Winter Soldier, and so you had this conversation. That fight scene we got, like the car chase scene, where Winter Soldier breaks out of the office, and Black Panther tries to kill him, Steve Rogers tries to protect him. Oh, and it wasn't the office, it was just like his apartment or whatever, and Black Panther was waiting there to kill him, and we had this long, drawn-out fight scene. That was amazing. That was like this is the level of like Winter Soldier type excitement action scenes. And so while I'm watching all this, I'm thinking, wow, what the hell is wrong with me? Why do I hate this movie? This movie's amazing. and we get further like character development, and the stuff with Zemo so far just seems okay. It seems legit. Like has his own plot going on. He's torturing people because he's trying to set things in motion, and eventually it escalates to the point where Zemo comes in and sets Winter Soldier, or sets Bucky off, and he turns into a villain again. So people like Iron Man are looking at it from very simplistic, and Black Panther, of course, is just driven by revenge and thinks it's overruling him. And so another fight breaks out, and Steve Rogers knows better. He knows Bucky's being framed, so he defends him, and people like Falcon, they stick up for him, and then eventually Hawkeye and Wanda, who are very much against it, of course, they stick up for Captain America, and ends up in this huge fight where Iron Man's forces try to stop Captain America's forces, and they meet ahead of that airport fight scene. And you know what? I bashed this airport fight scene in the past. I said it was Nerf football, that it was just, there were no real stakes. And watching it again, I see that I was wrong. There are real stakes. I felt the stakes for the, even if they were pulling their punches, which I did mention, which makes sense because they all know each other. But eventually it did get kind of gritty because they are like throwing like explosives at each other, and people could get hurt, and War Machine does get hurt at the end, and the stakes are really high. But they just, both sides really believe strongly in what they were doing, and so eventually leads to Captain America and Bucky getting away, and the rest of the people who supported Cap getting arrested and thrown in the prison. Okay, so up to this point, I'm thinking, wow, this is a great movie. This is almost just as good, maybe even just as good as Winter Soldier. Then, when we get to the ending, the next part of the movie, I was like, oh yeah, that's why I don't like this movie. That's why I often complain about it. That's what angered me so much, and that's why I always went on these angry rants about how much this movie sucks. The ending. And it's really a shame, too, because if they would have just landed this ending better, come up with a better ending that didn't retroactively make the villain completely convoluted and unbelievable, then this could have been a good movie. And also, of course, they ruin Iron Man's character as well with this ending. Alright, so I guess I gotta get into some detail about what I'm talking about. Now, Zemo's plot, I think I went into enough detail, and there's videos on the internet that, like I said, the Screen Junkies one with Lon Harris, it goes into a lot more detail about it, just how convoluted this plan is. And you know, it really upset me that so many comments were saying, oh, we're like really insulting Lon, saying that he's an idiot, he doesn't understand the movie, it all makes sense. I personally think these are all fanboys trying to make excuse for bad writing. And the biggest, I'm sorry, but this is really how I feel. I think any objective opinion would show that this is a contrived, convoluted plot that has no sense of realism, and it ruins the film. It ruins the film. No matter how much fanboys try to excuse it and make up excuses for it, all those excuses fall flat. They come off as nothing to me but lame excuses by fanboys who are too much of a fanboy to admit that this movie was written badly. Now, here, the biggest excuse that I've seen in the comment section was that Zemo improvised. Because a lot of people point out, well, how did Zemo plan all this if he didn't know the Accords were going to happen? It wasn't just a lucky, coincidence that the Accords happened, but a lot of people defending Zemo will say, well, he didn't know, his plan wasn't dependent on the Accords. His only plan was to get Captain America and Iron Man to fight. Now, my retort to that, which I have never seen, and Lon brought this up as well, and I've never seen anyone even address this. They tend to ignore this point and focus on the other points because I don't think, because they don't have a retort to it. And that is, if that's the case, why didn't he just put it on YouTube? If he had that footage of Cap Bucky killing Iron Man's parents, or Tony Stark's parents, why didn't he email it to Tony Stark when he knew that Tony Stark and Captain America were in the same room? Why did they just put it up on YouTube? Why make them go all the way to Siberia? And the way that they get him to go to Siberia is so convoluted. Like, so many things have to just fall into place perfectly to get them to this point. Now, and this is where people will say, oh, because Zemo is improvising. He's a genius. He sees the way things are unfolding and he manages to... But that actually, that explanation actually doesn't work. It doesn't fit. That's why I call it a fanboy excuse. Because many of the situations that happened to get them all to the point that make his plan work was pure luck and have absolutely nothing to do with anything that Zemo did. It just so happens that it's just Captain America and Bucky that goes. Because how did Zemo know that? And don't give me this shit about improvising, because you could say, oh, well, if other people showed up, he would have improvised more. Why didn't he just email it to them? And so much happens, like, outside of the control. Like, he calls the maid and to see the dead body, and that's to alert Iron Man to what's happening. Iron Man starts to suspect Zemo over the plot, so the Iron Man goes to help Cap. First of all, how do you know Tony Stark was going to come to that conclusion? If he didn't come to that conclusion, even if he did, like, how did he know he would actually want to help Captain America and go there? Maybe he would just try to cut him off and never actually get there at first. And I know people will say, oh, well, he would come up with something different. Like, the level of ever all the... Just these are just some examples. I'm willing to be clear about this, because if I could spend, it would take me hours to rip apart all the parts of this, like, plan that makes no sense. That most of it is not, it's not fucking improvisation. It's serendipity. It's luck. And so when there's some events full that's so much dependent on just the right things happening or just the right things falling into place and just the, you know, a lot of happy coincidence, happy circumstances that just so happen to lead to Zemo getting what he wants, that is not an excellent plan. That is contrived writing. When this happens in a film, there's a word for this. It's contrived writing. It's writers who want things to happen for a plot so things can unfold the way they want it to unfold, and so they just so happen to write it that way. They write it so this thing happens, so Zemo's plans work. They write it so that thing happens, that Zemo's plans work. This is bad writing. I'm sorry, it is. You can be in denial of that all you want, but this is an objective fact. This is bad writing. Now, you know, the biggest complaint that I've heard that from this, from, you know, the fanboys who fight against this, they'll say that, oh, well, Zemo's actually one of the best villains of the MCU because his plan worked. He was actually a genius because he was the only one of the only villains that won. His plan actually worked. Yeah, it worked because of contrived writing, because the writers contrived to write it that way. Even though it's not realistic, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't actually work in actual storms of storytelling. It's when you do stuff like that to contrive events because you want it to happen, because this is what you want the plot to go, but it doesn't actually unfold in a way that makes sense in terms of storytelling, then that is called bad writing, my friend. I'm sorry, you can be in denial of that all you want, but that's the fact. It's a fact. Not my opinion, it's a fact. But anyway, I'm sorry. Let me move on to this Tony Stark thing. And I touched on this in my preamble a little bit about how Tony Stark was, he wanted to kill Bucky. And I've heard people defend this too, and saying, and a lot of people would say, said to me, you know, strangers on the internet, would say, well, you know, if you were put in a room with the person who killed your parents, you would want to kill them too. Don't deny it. You know, it's funny, people who don't even know me are saying that. So I guess they're making the claim that anybody in general who was put in a room with the person who killed their parents, they would want to kill them. Now, I don't buy that. I think everyone's different. Everyone would have a different way of reacting. I mean, surely we wouldn't be happy about it. You could make the argument that a majority of people put in a room would want to kill the people who killed the parents. And more specifically, you can make the argument that Tony Stark has been established as the type of person who would want to kill the person who killed the parents. But here's the issue with that analogy, is that that's not what we're presented with in the film. We're not presented with a situation where the man who killed Tony Stark's parents is in the room with him and he wants to kill him. We're presented with a man who is brainwashed by conspiracy, by this Hydra conspiracy, and Hydra was the one who ordered they could use these safe control, mind control words and mind control effort to make this man go and kill Tony Stark's parents. So, in essence, Bucky was just a weapon. I mean, Hydra might as well just use like a remote control missile. That is the equivalent to what Bucky is. He was just a weapon. He had absolutely no conscious decision, no control over his actions. Like even early in the film, like Tony jokes around and calls him Manchurian Candidate. So he's fully aware, because Manchurian Candidate refers to someone who's been brainwashed. And he's fully aware that he was just a brainwashed weapon used by Hydra. Now, so I would make a different analogy, and I made this in the preamble, is that the analogy to this would be that if I found out I was in a room with a very specific knife, not a type of knife, but a very specific knife, and I found out that this exact knife was used to kill my parents. Someone else decided to use that knife to kill my parents, and I was in the room with this knife, and I tried to destroy this knife so badly, but my best friend was saying, no, I like this knife, don't destroy it, and was fighting me on this, so I was willing to beat the crap, perhaps even kill my best friend, just to the point of destroying this knife. That's the equivalent of what we get here. And so when people say, oh, you know that's what you would do, fuck no, that's not what I would do. I wouldn't try to kill my best friend just to kill this specific knife that was the one that killed my parents. I wouldn't fucking do it. And Tony Stark wouldn't fucking do it either, because the movie made it clear that he was full aware that Bucky was just a weapon. And I could maybe see that he might have an initial reaction, but we don't just see an instinctive initial reaction. We see a prolonged, thought-out, intelligent mission to kill Bucky, and he's willing to kill his friend Steve Rogers in order to do this. He constantly fights him. Whenever Steve Rogers tries to talk him out of it and be like, look, he's brainwashed, Tony Stark just ignores him. And here's the thing. A lot of people, like, watch this movie, some people, not a lot, and say Tony Stark is an asshole for doing this. That's not how my reaction to watching this scene. My reaction to the scene is, again, this is unbelievable. No person, especially no person, unless they're completely dumb or idiotic or insane, which Tony Stark has not been established to be. No sane, reasonable person, which Tony Stark has been established to be a sane, reasonable person, no sane, reasonable person would behave this way. Not at all. So when this scene happens, again, bad writing, contrived writing, because they want Steve Rogers and Tony Stark to fight in this fight to the death, and so they're like, they don't care that it actually doesn't make sense for anybody's character, unless they're completely insane, to behave in this way, to want to try to kill their best friend just so they can kill the weapon that others used to kill his parents. No, absolutely not. That is bad writing. I do not buy it for a single solitary second. So, the irony here, because I was loving this movie up until this ending that made Zemo's plot unbelievably contrived, and by that I mean it's unbelievable, I don't buy it, and then they had Tony Stark react in a way that's unbelievable, that I don't buy, that it's, again, plot contrivance. So it seems like lazy writing, it's contrived writing, but this happens at the end. So I was loving this movie up until this point. And so, the big irony here, because if you watch my videos, earlier videos on the MCU, I've railed against how most of these MCU movies have cliche, stereotypical comic book movie third acts, where it's a cliche ending where you have a big battle between good and evil, usually involving a sky beam or a faceless army, and the good guy has to battle it out with the evil bad guys, and they win the day. The irony here is I actually think they should have done that in this film. I probably would have still saw it as, oh, it's cliche, it's Marvel falling back on what they do, but if they had, this film would have been way better. I actually would have liked this film much, much better if they had just done a boring cliche ending, because that way Zemo's plot wouldn't have been so damn contrived, and that way Tony Stark wouldn't act so much out of fucking character. You cut out the worst bits of contrived bad writing, and therefore it would still be a good film. I mean, granted, so what I'm saying is, I hated the fact that the Winter Soldiers were just a contrivance. That also red herring. That also really much annoyed me that the other Winter Soldiers ended up just being a red herring. That because we think they're presented as if the plot is that Zemo was trying to get these other Winter Soldiers so he could, like, take over a country or take over the world, and that was his end game. I think they should have stuck with that. To be honest, I think that would have made a lot more sense, because his endgame being of wanting to destroy the Avengers from within, and it's just a happy coincidence that that was already happening without him because of the Accords. Contrived writing, not a coincidence. And he has to go through all these steps to get them there to Siberia, which it's very serendipitous that it actually fucking happens. When he could have just emailed it to them, if that was the case. Why didn't he email it to them? Nobody tells, because there's no, if someone does answer it, it'll probably just be bullshit anyway, because there is no answer. It's bullshit. It's contrived writing. And so, all that would have been eliminated if they simply just kept to Zemo's plot being taking the Winter Soldiers. And they could have had a stereotypical cliche battle where Iron Man, Captain America, and Bucky have to work together to kill the Winter Soldiers. And then the Black Panther could show up and arrest Zemo. He could have a similar thing about how revenge. Because that's one aspect of the ending I did like, if I'm being fair. Is I did like the aspect when Black Panther shows up and he realizes that he was consumed by his own need for vengeance, but he was going after the wrong person. He could see that the person who actually was responsible for his father's death was also consumed by his own vengeance, so was able to relate in that manner and not feel sympathy for him because he's still arrested, but I like how he stopped him, Zemo, from killing himself and forced him to live a life in prison. Like, that was one aspect of the ending I did like. So you can keep that. You can keep that aspect to it, but have Zemo be more about his revenge, is not about fighting. Because also, of course, like, his whole plot is dependent on Tony Stark being a completely insane, unreasonable person, by the way, which is absolutely not how any sane person would react. So his whole plot is doomed in the first place. Because I know another thing a lot of fanboys kept bringing up, they're like, oh no, Zemo's only plot was to make Captain America and Iron Man fight. That was his only plot. And again, why not email if that was his only plot? But even if that was his only plot, then it's dependent on Iron Man being a total fucking insane moron. And wanting to kill a knife, and willing to kill his best friend in order to kill a knife. That is the essentialness of it. So, again, that makes Zemo a fucking idiot. So, but they could have fixed all of this. They could have saved it if they just fell back to their cliche Marvel ending and had Zemo actually want to use the Winter Soldiers to overthrow a nation, and so they have to have a typical third act battle where Iron Man and Captain America work together to kill the Winter Soldiers, and they have this epic battle. They could even have a sky beam in there somewhere, and then it would have been, you get rid of all the issues of the movie, and it would actually, ironically, be a much better movie if they fell back to that cliche ending. Now, you might be saying, oh, well, Mark, that would get rid of the whole point of Iron Man and Captain America fighting. It's the whole point of the movie. They have to fight each other. I say bollocks to that. Because First of all, we got the airport fight scene, and that's enough to satisfy the two heroes fighting, in my opinion. And I actually think it would be more powerful on a character level that instead of Iron Man, you know, being a complete insane moron, that instead is the resolution to the movie being that him and Cap have to work together with Bucky in order to save the world. And that's what they presented the story to be before they pulled the wool over your eyes and revealed that the Winter Soldier is a red herring, which I think it was. People complain about the Mandarin reveal. I like the Mandarin reveal. I think this reveal is the worst fake out in all of the MCU. This ruined the movie. And so if instead that wasn't the case and it wasn't a reveal, it wasn't a red herring, it actually was the case that this was the plot, then it actually would have been a better character story. Because as it stands, that letter that Captain America sends Tony Stark at the end of the movie makes no sense. Because they left the point where Tony Stark was trying to kill Steve Rogers. Now all of a sudden he's okay with it because he sends him a letter. Like, this makes no sense. This makes no sense. But if you had a story where Tony Stark realized his mistake and he realized that they're stronger together, and I realize this is something they've already done before with the Avengers, but again, works, then this actually would have been a much more coherent movie, a stronger movie, a better character story. Now, enough of the ending. I want to go back to the beginning a bit more and talk about the Sokovia Accords, because that is another slight issue. Nowhere near as strong as an issue as I have with the ending, but a slight issue I have with the film is the Sokovia Accords themselves, because the people are being really obtuse here by blaming the Avengers for all these deaths. Now, the exception is the situation at the start of the film we see with Crossbones, because that was made in this film, so the film made it in order to fit the scenario, so it actually does fit the scenario, because the Avengers shouldn't have attacked Crossbones in a public place. They are partly responsible, because Crossbones didn't want to have this battle in the middle of the city. He just wanted to hijack and steal this thing. The Avengers tried to intercept and attacked him right in the middle of the city, so it caused this conflict to happen in a very public place, which resulted in collateral damage. So while I still wouldn't blame the Avengers and say that they're murderers, but they're maybe need to be a bit more, that's why I can see the argument being made that they need to be reined in a bit and were supervised, so to make sure that in the future, like, they have to get permission or there's supervision or whatever ahead to actually pull an op in a public place like that. So that part of it, I think, makes sense. The part that doesn't make sense is that they bring up Sokovia, and they bring up New York, and they bring up Washington, D.C. Specifically because the Ross, or whatever that guy is a fucking moron, he shows clips of the first Avengers movie where the monsters are attacking New York. He shows Age of Ultron, where Ultron, takes Sokovia and turns it into an asteroid. And he also shows from Captain America Winter Soldier where the freaking aircraft carriers in Washington, D.C. came crashing down. Now, those are horrible examples, because in the first Avengers, these aliens were going to attack New York regardless. And they were going to attack, even if Avengers weren't there. And if the Avengers weren't there, guess what? These aliens would have taken over all of the entire world. The entire world would be killed. Not to mention that the government, the same sort of operations that they want to supervise the Avengers, well, I guess in this case it was S.H.I.E.L.D., but still, they wanted to nuke New York. It was the Avengers that actually stopped the government from nuking New York and killing millions of innocent civilians would be dead if it wasn't for the Avengers. Not to mention, like, these aliens would conquer the whole world if it wasn't for the Avengers. So, as tragic as it could be that Hulk accidentally dropped a building on a civilian, and that is tragic, it's still preferable to the entire fucking world being killed or the entirety of New York being nuked, which is what the government, the people you want to supervise the Avengers, that's what they would have done. So I don't think that they're in the proper position to fucking supervise anyone. Now, Sokovia they tried to blame it on the Avengers because, or at least Tony Stark, for creating Ultron. And you could do that, but that's kind of roundabout. Because once Ultron is there, regardless of how he got there, he exists, he's going to try to wipe out the whole world. The Avengers needed to intercede. If they didn't intercede, the whole world would be wiped out. Not to mention, like, the whole, like, third act, or the last part of that battle in Avengers Age of Ultron, was all about the Avengers saving all the civilians. They went out of their way, in fact, risked their lives. In fact, the Quicksilver gave his life to save one child. He gave his life to save one child, and they were going out of their way to save all these civilians. So again, it is tragic that lady's son died in this event, but he, guess what? He would have died anyway. In fact, if the Avengers weren't there, everyone would have died. So, again, that makes no sense. Now, the other one was Washington D.C., the Winter Soldier. So, this wasn't the Avengers, first of all. It was just Captain America, Falcon, and Black Widow. But still, if they hadn't interceded, a fourth of the world's population would have been wiped out instantly. Or maybe it was even more than half. I can't remember, but it was a lot. S.H.I.E.L.D. wanted to, and I'm struck by how similar their plan is to Thanos's. But anyway, S.H.I.E.L.D. wanted to wipe out, a significant amount of the world's population, and had Captain America and Bucky, or not Bucky, he was on the other side, but Captain America and Black Widow and Falcon, had they not interceded, S.H.I.E.L.D. would have been successful. And this fuckhead is complaining about an aircraft carrier crashing, when the alternative to that aircraft carrier crashing is a fourth of the world population instantly being wiped out. What the fuck is wrong with this guy? His argument is so nonsensical, so weak, and it makes no sense that, as I said earlier, that it made sense that Tony Stark's character, that he would go along with it, but the way it's presenting this movie is such a weak argument, and I think Captain America's argument that, hey, Hydra was this government agency that had oversight over the Avengers, and they nearly wiped out the whole fucking world. So now you want to give oversight to another committee that could just as easily be corrupted. He's 1,000% in the right. And that's another problem I had, is a lot of people who love this movie would be like, oh, it's so great because you could see both their points of view. You could side with Iron Man, you could side with Captain America, and you think they both have good, valid points. No, bullshit! Iron Man's clearly in the wrong, and Captain America's clearly in the right. So, that diminished the whole, oh, here's two sides fighting, because one was clearly a moron, the other was clearly correct. But maybe that is just my opinion, though. I will admit to that. If they would have landed that ending, I would have been willing to forgive these mistakes. I would have been willing to overlook the whole Sokovia Accord mistakes, because ultimately it was a good movie. But since they had that horrible ending that sort of invalidated the entire thing, it isn't a good movie. Now, my rating for Captain America Civil War out of 10 is a 6 good. Now, this is something I gave a lot of thought to, I struggled with. As I said, I was curious to if I would keep this movie at a 7. And I was very tempted to keep it at a 7 because I love the movie so much for most of its run. As I said, like the fight sequence with Black Panther and the car sequence was amazing. The airport sequence I thought was even better than I remember. I think I was being too harsh on it before. That was a really great moment in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And I can see why a lot of people would hyper-focus on that moment and why they would put this film so up. But that ending did ruin the movie, and I gotta be honest about that. I would put this movie so much higher if they would have just got that ending correct. I mean, this might even get a 9 or a 10 if they would have landed the ending, but they didn't. The fact is that they retroactively made Zemo an unbelievable character. They make the ending resolution with Tony Stark a really unbelievable character. And therefore, it does hurt the film entirely. Now, I am still willing to give it a 6 because the majority, I almost compare it to like Game of Thrones or Lost, because the majority of those, you know, of the run was amazing, was awesome. It's just the ending sucked. And it's the same thing with this film. And so therefore, I got to at least give it a positive rating. But it's the lowest positive rating I can give it because they did botch the ending too horribly. Anyway, so I said my piece about Civil War now. So let me move on to the next film, which is a Doctor Strange. So Doctor Strange, I've only seen this once in the theater, and as I said, this is when I was really anticipating this movie. This is the part of the MCU where I was anticipating almost every movie coming out. This one in particular looked really cool. But when I first saw it, I wasn't really that impressed with it because, I mean, I liked it, but I think my expectations were a bit high because people were comparing it to Inception from the trailers because it looked very, like, visually looked similar. So I guess I went in expecting a more, like, cerebral, sort of mind-bendy film like Inception was, and that's not really what I got. What I got was a film where the protagonist acted a bit like Tony Stark. He was too much like Tony Stark. He's just another version of Tony Stark. And that really annoyed me. And I think that this film did fall back too much on those stereotypical MCU tropes. And it didn't sort of where I was expecting it to be a lot more unique and, as I said, cerebral and mind-bendy. Although I did really love that ending, I did think that was unique in the MCU, and there are other aspects of the film I thought were really unique, but I don't remember it being particularly amazing. So anyway, I'm going to go watch that now, and maybe I've changed my mind after seeing it more recently. Maybe I'll see it differently. I'll be back to let you know. Okay, so I just come back from watching Mr. Doctor, or that is Doctor Strange, and yeah, I actually liked it a lot better on this rewatch. I think perhaps I was being a bit too harsh on it when I first saw it because I had expectations, but now I didn't have those expectations. I went in knowing what to expect, and I was able to appreciate it a lot more because I wasn't holding it to unfair standards anymore. And if I want to be perfectly honest, when I first saw this movie, I was stoned off my ass because I thought it would be cool to, like, oh, all the visuals would be cool to see it on weed. That was actually a bad idea because it actually I had a hard time paying attention to the film, and actually it was very distracting. I mean, it was cool seeing on the big screen, seeing all the visuals, because the visuals are amazing, but I think it actually detracted from me appreciating the visuals, to be honest. So I think it was just a bad idea overall. Not that that's something I do very often, haven't done it in, I think that might have been the last time, but neither here nor there. Anyway, so I was able to appreciate it a bit more this time, because this is actually the first time I've seen it since then. So it's the first time I saw it with a clear head. And also, as I said, I didn't have those hang-ups, like, because I was really disappointed that Strange ended up, as I said in the preamble, being like Tony Stark copy. But this time, watching it, I don't think that's true. Like, I watched the honest trailer for this, and they were actually, like, pointing out how it's pretty much how similar the plot is to the first Iron Man movie. And they were like, it's basically the first Iron Man movie on weed. But I don't actually think that's the case. Even though they do make some points to the similarities in plot, I do find, particularly the character of Stephen Strange, I do think is rather different than Tony Stark. I mean, yeah, he's a egotistical, you know, quippy kind of guy, but in a very different way. I mean, would it be better if he was a bit more of original as a character? Sure. If from what I remember the comics, and it's a funny thing because I think when I was a kid I hated the comics. I don't know, I'm not sure why, because I thought it was boring. So from what I recall the comics, that Stephen Strange was a lot more of a stoic, more boring character, and maybe that's just doesn't fit the MO of the MCU where everyone has to be quippy. But I do think maybe it would have been better if they played it off as more of a serious and not such an egotist. But I think his egotism was quite different than Tony Stark's. I think he was more of an outright asshole at times, particularly after his injury, which is a bit understandable, a bit realistic. So I actually liked how that played out. But ultimately, because I was bashing it for not being cerebral enough, or mind-twisty, or mind-bending enough, but watching it now, I actually do think it is a bit mind-bending. It's not, it's definitely not in the same vein as Inception or something like that, but it does play, like, the way it plays with time travel and some of the more weirder things, like the visuals are amazing, first of all. Like, I think so far in the MCU, this film is the standout as far as visuals go. In fact, I think I would put this film up there of any film as having some of the most visually stunning special effects, visually stunning visuals. I would put it right up there with Inception. Not just like the stuff with the building twisty thing, which was really cool, but also like the ending where Dormammu comes, and just the visuals on Dormammu and the, like, the strange cosmic visuals we have. It's very psychedelic, which from what I understand that the comic of Doctor Strange was written, first created in the 60s, and was meant to be very psychedelic. That definitely came across here. But the way it blended seamlessly into, like, the modern plot, I think, was actually really good. And I think the character story that Stephen Strange went through in this film was also really well constructed. Like, I think a lot of the MCU movies having sat and watched almost all the MCU movies, well, up to this point, in a row, I did notice how the majority of MCU movies don't have a well-structured plot. They tend to be all over the place. Like, all three Iron Man movies like that, particularly Iron Man 2, which was really all over the place. And most of the MCU movies, like Captain America Civil War, the one that I just watched, had way too many diverse, here's Spider-Man, here's Ant-Man, here's this, here's that, and it doesn't have, like, a focused plot. And Avengers Age of Ultron was particularly bad as far as that goes as well. And it's not just the team-up. You think, oh, Mark, those are the team-up movies. Now, some of the solo movies, like The Incredible Hulk and Thor Dark World, like that, who knows what the fuck's going on in that film. Like, they're very disjointed, not very clear, have straightforward, well-constructed plots. And this film does. This film probably is the most, like, most well-constructed character journey in the MCU yet. And I totally bought Doctor Strange's transformation. Now, the thing that I kind of didn't buy is how he seemed to go from novice, who didn't even believe in this magic mumbo jumbo magic BS, to being the head wizard in charge of everything. That seemed to happen a bit too fast. Now, especially at the start of the film, they even said, the Ancient One said, oh, it would take years of study and practice, and yet he seems to be the main wizard within a couple of days. But I say that because, but I don't know what the span of the film actually was in terms of in-universe time frame. It could have actually been years. They don't make it particularly clear. I mean, they didn't age very well, so it couldn't be like decades, but it could have been like 3 or 4 years as far as I know. I don't know. I don't know if anyone, maybe some of the more hardcore geeks have studied this and know the answer to this one. From what I understand, the whole timeline of the MCU is a bit fucked up anyway. I've seen some fans trying to put it together, but really it doesn't fit. So they kind of have to shove some things together and make stuff up in order to make it fit. But because it's interesting, because they mentioned Stephen Strange in Captain America Winter Soldier, when one of the Hydra people say named him as one of the people who are dangerous that they plan on killing with their, you know, program thingy. And I thought at the time I saw that, it's like, well, Stephen Strange is just a doctor at the time this film came out, so why do they care? Like, the stuff with the wizard thing hasn't even happened yet, but maybe not. Maybe the time frame of this film spans several years, so by the time that thing happened with Hydra, it was after Stephen Strange became a wizard. Maybe. I don't know, but maybe that's not the case. Maybe I'm giving this film and the MCU in general too much credit. But that was my main complaint about it. But overall, like, I was really impressed. I like all the fight scenes with the visuals, especially it starts with the Ancient One attacking those people, and they have all those building twisty visuals. Like, those are amazing. These are definitely among the best fight sequence. Like, I'm just a huge fan of how trippy these visuals are, and the special, as I said, the appearance of Dormammu and how he looked, and apparently he was played by Benedict Cumberbatch as well, but that was all really amazing. But of course, what I really love is the ending. Like, this to me is a unique third act, because most of the MCU movies have this, you know, as I talked about previously, I actually encouraged it in the previous movie, but I definitely don't encourage it here, is that most of these MCU movies have a very stereotypical cliche third act. There's a sky beam, there's a faceless army, and the heroes have to attack another villain who's just a different version of themselves. And they did something completely different here. They did the whole where Stephen Strange realized he couldn't win, and the only way to win was to stalemate. And that scene, that gives me chills. Like, I can't express how much I love that scene, that Dormammu, I've come to bargain. Like, I mean, I did a review of Doctor Strange on my channel before, but it was a spoiler-free one right after I saw it, so I wasn't able to get into any detail. All I said was, Dormammu, I've come to bargain, so those who've seen the film knew what I was talking about. But that scene was so good. It was so unique. And this is what I think about the film overall, is that there's certain parts of it that evoke, like, Harry Potter. Like, some of the music they played when Strange was learning to be a wizard sound very Harry Potter-esque to me. Yeah, and then other people say that the plot's too similar to Iron Man, and that the Stephen Strange acts a lot like Tony Stark, but then it evokes other types of, like, Inception with the visuals. And even though it's similar to Harry Potter, it has wizards, but they're adults, not children, so it has a totally different feel. So I would ultimately say, especially with that ending is like nothing I've seen before. This film is probably the most creative and the most unique film in the MCU, at least to date. It is definitely stands out apart from, I wouldn't at all call it a stereotypical comic book movie. It combines all these elements from films like that, like Harry Potter or Iron Man or Inception and other things to create, but it never copies or rips off any one of them. It kind of creates its own unique thing that I think is the most unique film in the MCU. And that ending where he created a time loop, that was beautiful, that he was willing, and it was a great ending to his character story too, because this whole thing was about ego, and the agent one kept saying that he became a doctor for his own ego when he convinced himself it was about saving people's lives, but it wasn't really. In fact, towards the beginning of the film, he reminded me a lot of House. If you ever watch House, he had that sort of, he didn't care about patients or people, he just cared about mysteries and solving the medical problems. And that's the way Strange seemed to be. And in his character journey, he came to realize that it wasn't really about saving people, and he learned that that was the best way he could save people, and he was willing to suffer an eternal existence of pain, of dying over and over and over again, in order to spare the earth. And that was really powerful, and you bought that, where Dormammu was like, you will experience pain for the rest of eternity, and he's like, yes, but then Earth will be okay, because you will be too preoccupied, you'll be stuck here with me, and that way you can't harm the Earth. Like, that was powerful. And then, of course, and I love how the way they present the ending, where he shows up and he says, Dormammu, I've come to bargain, and at first you don't know what the hell he's talking about, but then he keeps saying it again, and again, and again, and then finally Dormammu is like, oh, you know, what do you want? He's like, you won, boy, and he's like, no, I've come to bargain. That's what I've been saying all along. Like, that was so good. It was such a unique way that was not just a stereotypical boss fight between a super villain that has the same powers as a superhero. Like, this is a really unique film that sort of really breaks the mold of the MCU, even though it is kind of similar to Iron Man in structure, as the Honest Trailers point out. But I think they're being a bit too unfair on this film, to be honest. I actually love that. And then I love how you had that other doctor who was kind of portrayed as the moron, as the adversary of Strange, and Strange kind of humiliates him. But I love how later on in the film, Strange actually comes to trust him, and because his hands are still fucked up, and he can't operate, so he gives it to this other doctor and says, please do it. And he does it in such a humble way. And I hope that they play on that more. Now, and also, it did have elements of effective humor. Like, I love the running joke about how Wong doesn't joke, and he doesn't laugh at things, and at the very end, you know, Strange makes this quip to the villains that, oh, that's why you should have read the whole book, because you need to read the consequences of the spells before actually doing it, which is something that Wong had said to him earlier. And then Wong would just start cracking up laughing at that. It's like, you're funny. Like, that was well earned. Like, all the character interactions, Strange's relationship to the other doctor, they were all well earned. I actually love this movie a lot more on the rewatch, and I am going to say this is one of the better movies of the MCU. Now, the post-credit scene that implied that what's-his-face, Mordo, or whatever his name was, the other wizard, that he's going to turn into a villain, I'm not such a huge fan of that. Like, that seems a bit silly to me, but I mean, I guess they're saying it because he was whole, so by the book and by the rules, and that Strange solution was to break the rules, and they found out that the agent went all along with breaking the rules, and he's just like, no, fuck that shit, you're all wrong for breaking the rules, I'm by the book. Nah, I don't know if I'm a huge fan of that. But overall, I was surprised how much I like this movie. So my rating for Doctor Strange out of 10 is a 9. Excellent. And I almost gave this an 8, but I was like, no. That ending was so good, this movie deserves a 9. So I would put it up there as one of the best of the MCU. So anyway, let me now get into the next film, which is Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Now, from what I recall this film, I didn't like it as much as the first one. I remember it being okay. I think I'm not looking forward to that long, drawn-out sequence when that blue dude dies at the end. I thought, like, they overplayed that too long and meant it to be, oh, isn't that sad? And having Sylvester Stallone and all the other, whatever the dudes they're called, being like, oh, let's play tribute to them. I was like, that's cheesy. I don't know. I'm not looking forward to watching that again. And from what I recall, Drax was really annoying in this film. I didn't like him at all. And he was being, like, outright cruel to Mantis. And I was like, they're playing it up for jokes. And I'm like, that's not funny. He's just an asshole. How's that? I don't get it. I don't get the humor in this. But I remember I love Baby Groot. Baby Groot was so cute. I know, I fell for it, but I'm sorry. That much I remember. I like the chemistry with the Guardians, you know, the main characters, really worked in the first film, and I remember it really working in the second film. I just remember the second film just being a bit not as focused and a bit sort of divergent, having subplots that, like the whole thing with Ego, I don't remember that being very interesting. And as I said, Drax was very annoying. And then they had those gold-faced people that just seemed annoying. Anyway, so I remember thinking it was okay, but nothing great. So let me go watch it, and I'll come back and see what I think. Okay, so I've watched Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, and, yeah, it's pretty much just as average as I remember it being. It's got some really good points and some really bad points, so I find it a very mix, because there's some scenes I'm like, wow, that's actually really good, and other scenes I'm like, yeah. I mean, overall, I can pin down the low points of the film to humor. And humor is a very subjective thing, so it's hard to judge these things. And some people might have found this movie hilarious, whereas just from my sensibilities, I did not think this was nearly as funny as the first film, nor did I think the chemistry between the characters worked as well, generally speaking. I think, as I said in my preamble, I did not like Drax in this film, and I absolutely hold that true. Like, I've watched some reviews where people said they loved Drax and they thought he was hilarious. I universally didn't like him in this film, whereas in the first film I didn't mind him. I thought he was fine. But here he was actively annoying, and I just wish he'd shut the hell up. Like, some of the jokes he said, like, ha ha ha, I have enormously, famously huge turds. I'm like, people find that funny? Really? I mean, no judgments here, but I don't at all. I was like, just grow. Like, what's funny about that? And then he's constantly saying they turned him into a dumbass. Like, he wasn't this dumbass. He was just someone who took things literal in the first film. When this film, he's a dumbass. Like, when they're talking to Ego, and Ego's explaining who he is in his backstory. He's like, did you create a penis? Like, shut up, Drax. That's not funny. I'm sorry, but it's not. And then I really did not like how he was actively, like, constantly, like, cruel to Mantis for what seems like no good reason whatsoever. Constantly telling her how disgusting and ugly she is, when I personally think she's kind of hot, if I'm going to be honest. and constantly putting her down it seemed like they were doing this as a running joke for it to be funny, but I didn't find it funny at all. I found it annoying. And then sometimes he would compliment her. He would always make sure to backstep. Like, at the end, he's like, oh, you're beautiful on the inside. And I'm like, shut up, Drax. Why are you being such a dick? Like, this made me appreciate this character a lot less. And then the opening sequence, when they were fighting a huge monster thingy with all his teeth, and Drax, like, allowed himself to be eaten for no good reason because he wouldn't have any. That whole thing was dumb. Like, I think maybe there were one or two jokes with Drax that I thought were kind of funny, okay, but for the most part, I didn't like him. Now, another drawback to the movie is, it's funny because these are Marvel MCU movies. They've always played fast and loose with the laws of physics and realism. I mean, they're comic book movies. They're Marvel movies. It's kind of what you expect. But I don't know why, but for some reason, I think this movie takes it over the extreme sort of attests my suspension of disbelief, and I think it surpasses that boundary. One scene in particular, because, you know, they've never really been true to the laws of space and physics, and like some people complain that in this film, when people were tossed out in space, they took too long to die. I don't care about that. I mean, these are Marvel movies. What do you want? But the one scene in particular, it was too much for me to suspend my disbelief was when towards the beginning of the film, when the Guardian ship was crash landing on the planet, and Drax was hanging out like on a wire, and Gamora like was holding on to it, and she was like hanging onto the edge of the ship and holding onto the wire, like, and Drax, while the ship was like crashing into trees going at terminal velocity, and Drax was just banging into all these trees while Gamora was like holding onto the ship. That's too far for me. That is way too far. First off, Gamora would never be able to hold on to the ship. She would lose her arm before that, the kind of speeds they were flying at. There's no way she would be able to hold on to both those things. I was about to say human being. But Mark, she's an alien. I don't give a fuck. No alien, no humanoid would be able to hold on to that speed, to that velocity. And Drax got killed at least 100 times. Like, every time he smacked into the tree, dead. Dead, dead, dead. And again, as you say, but Mark, he's a tougher kind of alien. Alright, so maybe he only died a couple times. Maybe he's got thicker skin than human beings. But he's still dead! No humanoid could survive that. Never to mention the fact that there's no way that Gamora would have been able to hold on to him. So that scene really bothered me for some reason. Now, I'm going to talk about another thing. This is not a huge issue for me, but I know I'm probably going to get a lot of, how dare you, about this one. But I got to be honest here. I'm not a fan of the music. The music in the first movie didn't bother me, but I didn't really see it as a huge positive as a bunch of people did. In fact, it kind of just confused me to make me think, well, what's the point? I mean, I know the end story reason is because Star-Lord was taken as a kid, so in the 80s, so what he sort of romanticizes his background or his mother by listening to all the 70s and 80s music. But it just, they overdid it to the point, like, that's why I didn't mind it as much in the first movie, because it kind of made sense for his character's background. But even in the first movie, I often wondered, like, what really the point is having Peter be from Earth, because it didn't really seem that relevant to the story. I mean, he was raised pretty much in outer space, so it seems like they could have, that whole thing was just superfluous, and they could have done away with it entirely. But then, in this film, it seemed even more extraneous and unnecessary, and more like a gimmick. And I'm gonna be honest, I don't care for this type of music. Like, one time I listened to the soundtrack, and I was listening to song after song, and I start to realize, I don't like these songs. And so, maybe that's just my taste in music. Everyone has different taste in music. But it's not like I don't like any classic rock or any stuff from the 70s, but this stuff in particular is just kind of generic and bland to me. I'm sorry. I mean, there's a few exceptions, Fleetwood Mac. I'm not going to call them generic, but generally speaking, I just don't care for this kind of music. And I don't hate it. It doesn't actively distract me, but it actively distracts me in this film, but not because I don't like the music, because I think it's kind of a gimmick. It seems very gimmicky and unnecessary. In fact, I got a huge argument with Josh over Thor Ragnarok, which I'll cover a bit later in this video, because he thought that was trying too hard to be like Guardians. But I honestly, and I'll cover this when I get to it, I think they blended the music much, 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 much better than particularly this film did, because it wasn't overwhelming. Like, it wasn't constantly there, so it didn't feel like a gimmick, and it blended so well with the tone and the feel and the action scenes of the film, whereas I thought the music in this movie did not. A lot of times they tried to force it by having, like, these cool slow-mo walks and stuff, but it seemed really unnecessary, particularly the song they played. They played the Fleetwood Mac song when Star-Lord finally, you know, started kicking ass against his father. And that seemed like the wrong musical choice. It didn't seem to go well with it. And I think as I said, the first movie, I didn't love it, but it didn't bother me. It actively bothered me. And I remember when I first saw this, I was constantly asking myself, what is the point of this soundtrack? It just, so to me, just smacks of a gimmick, which I don't really care for. I'm sorry, I know I'm going to get a lot of hate over that, because the people love the music, but I don't, I just don't. Just don't. And and this story is another example of classic MCU meandering stories that wander off. This definitely is a drawback from the first film, that it does meander a lot. Particularly the scenes with, Star-Lord and everyone on Ego's planet. Like, it kind of comes to a halt. And I do kind of like the Peter Quill and Gamora relationship. I will say that. And this, getting back to the humor, the one scene I did really love, but this was ruined for me in the trailers anyway, the one scene I did really think is funny is when Mantis was revealing her abilities to read people's feelings, and she said specifically to Star-Lord that you have sexual feelings towards Gamora, and Drax just starts laughing hysterically and being like, oh, she just revealed your deepest, darkest secret, you must be so embarrassed. And then Mantis is like, oh, I'll feel what, you know, what Drax is feeling now. And she started laughing and pointing at Peter too. That was the one place where they used Drax where I actually thought it worked, where I thought it was hilarious, because he wasn't being a cruel dumbass in that case. I mean, you could say he was being a bit unkind to Star-Lord, but to me that felt more in his character from the first film, and not just being an enormous dickhead. That felt more like a bit more naivete, and he sort of, like, even though in the moment didn't feel this way, but it sort of could relate to the feeling that in some cases that how he would feel if his deepest, darkest secrets was released. But he just has a lighthearted attitude towards it in general. But that was a funny scene, I've got to admit. And I did like, now moving more towards the stuff I did like the action sequences involving Rocket. I thought Rocket was actually constant in this movie. Although, I thought the thing about him stealing the battery seemed to come out of nowhere. And it seemed like this was, like, an unnecessary side plot with the Sovereign, where they're, like, all high and mighty. Rocket was funny in that beginning scene, where he called, oh, I heard you were douchebags, and he almost got them killed. The whole stealing the batteries thing for apparently no reason. I mean, I suppose it's going along with his character of being just a thief for no reason, but I think they took, I don't know, it just seemed really unnecessary. Like, they did take it too far. They did try to tie it back into it later in the film, which I did appreciate, where Yondu was bringing up this is the reason why you're just stealing batteries for no good reason. It's because you're trying to compensate for something. But I don't know, so I didn't really hate it, but it was kind of, I don't know. But I did love, like, the scenes on the planet when Rocket was attacking all the Ravengers that were trying to get the ship. Like, that was a really cool sequence. The stuff with them, the Ravengers turning on Yondu, and the whole taser face thing. Okay, that was definitely funny, particularly the scene when Rock was making fun of him. And he was like, oh, do you wake up in the morning and look in the mirror like, oh, Taser Face, that's such a badass name. Like, I lost my shit during that scene. That scene was actively hilarious. So Rocket was sort of the opposite of Drax to me, where Rocket I thought was used properly, and especially Baby Groot. You should know how I feel about Baby Groot. Watching this again, after having seen that, I wasn't as big on Baby Groot, if I'm being honest, but I still thought he was cute. And the particular scene towards the end. And again, this is a lot of the best parts of this film were given away in the trailers. And this is the problem with trailer culture. Now, not all movies fall victim to this, but I think this, I could tell when I saw the trailers, I'm like, These trailers I'm watching are probably, they're just giving away all the best parts of the film, aren't they? And they are. The thing with the Drax about your deepest, darkest secret, and the thing with Baby Groot saying, "Don't press this button," Rocket is like, "If you press this button, we all die." And Baby Groot's like, "I am Groot," and he keeps going to that same button. Like, that was hilarious, but they gave it away in the trailers. And so, yeah, so I like the Yondu stuff, like the stuff with the where he killed everyone all at once. I mean, that was a pretty brutal scene, and they played it pretty lightheartedly, but I guess all those people he killed, they showed them earlier, like, killing a bunch of his crew ruthlessly, and, you know, they were going to betray him, so you think, oh, they deserve it, but both those things together, that was really brutal for the MCU. I think, anyway, but I don't know. And as I said, I think the chemistry between, like, the sense of the Guardians being family, that did come through towards the end, and I did appreciate that, especially, I gotta admit, I got a bit choked up when they had that hero shot of all the Guardians on the planet going like that. But of course, they ruined it when they had a rock slam into Mantis for no good reason. And then Drax says another stupid joke. He's like, "Mantis, look out." Oh, that's not funny. But before, and just the how they refer to themselves as family. But I will say that this sense was not as strong nor as well earned as it was in the first film. So plus the main storyline with Ego, I wasn't really that interested in, if I'm being honest. And I thought his turn to being revealing that he's evil was kind of felt a bit melodramatic to me, and I didn't really care for it that much. I don't think it's horrible or anything, but yeah. And Yondu's death, I talked about this in the preamble. I actually did like Yondu's death. I should clarify, and I didn't know this beforehand. After rewatching it, I actually realized, like, his actual death, where he takes Peter up into space and he gives him the spacesuit, and Peter's like screaming. I must admit to getting a bit teary-eyed about that, and I did think that was extremely powerful and a good character story for Yondu, despite the fact that a very strong argument could be made that this completely goes against how he was established in the first movie, but I'm willing to give that a little pass, because if you look at this movie in isolation, it actually really works for Yondu's character journey. But what I didn't like was the Ravager funeral. That was too much. Like, that, I think that was the part I was more referring to in my preamble, where I didn't give a shit. Where they were milking their, it was a good, powerful death, but they were milking it too much and going too far with it. I didn't give a fuck about these other Ravengers. And then they got together and, like, why would they have, like, these rituals where they set off fireworks when the Ravager dies? Like, that sounds a bit stupid to me, and I just really didn't care. And then they get back in the post-credits scene, they're like, "Oh, let's go steal shit." And I'm like, okay, so these thieves have these... I don't know. I thought that was dumb. I'm sorry. I did. But anyway, so my rating for Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, I think I'm going to give this a 6. I came into this thinking I'd give it a 7, but I think I'm going to slightly drop it to a 6 again. It's a strong 6. It's like right on the edge of being a 7, because I don't give decimal points, if you know me. So this would be like a 6.8 or something like that. But I'm giving it a 6 rather than a 7, because, yeah, I just don't... it was a good, enjoyable movie. There are parts of it that worked, but I think the plot as a whole kind of fell apart, and even though the humor with Rocket and Groot really worked, the humor with Drax really did not. I'm sorry, that really actively annoyed me. And it just overall did not work as well as the first film. So, that's it for Guardians of the Galaxy, so now let me move over to the next film, which is Spider-Man Homecoming. Now, full disclosure, I actually have seen this movie fairly recently, so this preamble is probably not going to be much different than after I go and rewatch it, because I saw this movie a couple months ago when Spider-Man Far From Home came out. I watched this movie with my parents, who had never seen it before, before we went to the theater and saw Spider-Man Far From Home. So that was just, what, like 3 months ago, so it's still pretty fresh in my mind. So I almost like didn't even want to go rewatch it because I've seen it so recently. But, you know, just to keep tradition, I'm, you know, might as well just go and rewatch it. And traditionally, like before that rewatch, I always saw this movie as one of the best of the MCU. After the rewatch, I thought, well, maybe it's not as great as I remember it being, but I still really like it a lot. I think Michael Keaton is definitely the strength. I gotta be honest, I'm not a fan of having Larissa Torme play Aunt May, having a hot Aunt May. I don't like that, just me personally. Just saying. But and I think Tom Holland as Spider-Man is fine. I actually prefer an older Spider-Man, if I'm being honest, because when I was a kid, when you're a young kid, you don't really tell the difference between older teenagers and adults very much. They all seem like adults to you. So I never got into the, I always thought of Spider-Man as a man, even though there are a lot of comics that do specifically play off of him being a teenager in high school. I don't know, I just wasn't paying attention, I guess, or I focused more on the older portrayals of Spider-Man. But that being said, I love, this is definitely my favorite incarnation of Spider-Man. I think Tom Holland does an amazing job, and I've went on record, this is the only, well, now Far From Home as well, but these incarnation of Spider-Man is the only movies I really like. I hated the Tobey Maguire stuff. Even the first two movies, some people hold them up really high. I never liked them, I'm gonna be honest. And I didn't like, of course, the Andrew Garfield reboots thing. They were just as bad. So I actually actively hated Spider-Man movies until this movie. This is the first time there was a Spider-Man movie that I actually liked. I'm therefore, by default, it was the best Spider-Man movie, in my opinion. And I do think it's a bit better than Far From Home, so it's still the best Spider-Man movie, in my opinion. I did really love it. I thought the humor really worked. Michael Keaton was a huge, huge high point. I think he is still one. I still hold him up before. I'll see how I feel after I rewatch the whole MCU. But before, I was saying that he is the best villain of the entire Marvel Cinematic Universe. Now, we'll see if I still feel this way by the end of it. But yeah, I definitely do think he's up there. So, we go rewatch Spider-Man Homecoming, come back and give my feelings on that movie. So, just got back from watching Spider-Man Homecoming. I have to say, I said I just saw this movie 3 months ago, and my opinion of it probably wouldn't change very much, but it kind of did. I actually think much higher of this movie now. I see why I said before this is one of the best movies of the MCU, because this is one of the best movies of the MCU. This is top tier for me. I talked about how a lot, yeah, I think I've said that a lot in this video in particular, about how, ooh, this movie has a well-structured plot, because most of the MCU movies don't. Well, this movie really does, and I think it's, I talked about this in Doctor Strange a bit, but I think this is even better than Doctor Strange. This is a better character story, and I think it's one, I think it's, not only is this one of the best movies of the MCU, this is one of the best superhero comic book movies ever, in my opinion. And bear in mind, as I said, I'm not a fan of Spider-Man. I didn't like any of the Spider-Man movies, not the Sam Raimi ones. I hated them. So this is the first Spider-Man movie I actually like, and I actually thought it was really, really good. Also, I didn't talk about this much in Civil War because I didn't want to go on about that movie too long, but I didn't like the introduction to Spider-Man in that movie. It felt very out of place and shoved in, because it was, because when they first started writing that movie, Marvel didn't have the rights to Spider-Man. They came up with a deal, and they were like, oh, let's shove him in there, and I could really tell. So I wasn't actually thinking, having much high expectations for this movie. But it turned out to have, a really full, well-developed character story of Peter Parker. Now, and I will stand behind that this is the best, the Vulture, played by Michael Keaton in this film, is the best villain of the MCU. I know I still have a few more movies left in my rewatch, but from memory, Like, I'm not a fan of Thanos. I'll throw that out there, but I'll cover that more in the next video. And I'll get the Black Panther soon, and then they have, I'm blanking on his name, but I'll get there soon. The villain who's in Black Panther, he was good too. I liked him too. But I think the Vulture's better. I think they do a better job of making the Vulture seem like an everyman, and like a well-rounded character. Like, you totally buy, and you actually sympathize him with him to a certain extent. And that's true of the villain in Black Panther as well, but he's a bit nutso. Whereas Michael Keaton's character, you understand him a lot more. Because he's, especially that opening scene, like, I don't remember that opening scene at all. It makes me wonder, like, maybe last time I watched it a couple months ago, I walked in like halfway through or missed the first 5 or 10 minutes, because I don't remember that opening scene. I remember there was a title card that said 8 years later, just because all the fanboys went crazy over it, because it fucks up the continuity of the MCU, and the MCU really doesn't line up with that tag that says 8 years later. I mean, according to them, I never looked at it myself. I don't really care all that much, to be honest. But so I know that I've seen it before. I just have no memory of it. And it was such a good, it was so amazing. Like, this showed Michael Keaton's character, like, as a contractor. I mean, this is what I love about this movie a lot, like, through and through, is that this is the most sort of down-to-earth, like, on an everyday level kind of film. And this is what I liked about the Marvel Netflix shows as well, although those I think kind of lost their way after a while, and I think that this is better, actually. But it's that same sort of street level, rather than like following like demigods or billionaires in mechanical suits that could care, basically magical, or a bunch of people flying out in space defying the laws of physics, like all these grandiose. Or like a wizard who can affect reality and shit. This is more ground to earth, down to earth, more grounded. Just a boy who has some super abilities, but at the heart of it, he's just a boy. And the super abilities aren't that crazy. They're not like the wizard worker that can make reality go, like a big turn into a big green guy who can smash buildings. It's just, he shoots webs out of his hands. And I think this movie correctly identified that is just a simplistic thing, and they dealt with this character on that level. And I think that's why it works more than the other Spider-Man films, which all try to make it more grandiose, like a big, here's a big action set piece, ooh, the world's gonna end. And it's so nice to have a film that is so much more grounded, where the stakes aren't the world's gonna end. The stakes are quite low, and I think that is actually an awesome thing. It's a good thing, because this is something I brought up a lot. This is what I heard when I was studying script writing, is, or story, any kind of story writing, is that the stakes of your film are only as high as they feel to your characters. So the stakes of the film doesn't have to be the world's gonna end or everyone's gonna die. It could just be this guy's gonna lose his girlfriend. If, as long as it's written in such a way where you identify with the characters, and the characters feel the stakes, then the audience will feel the stakes. And I think this is so true for this film, because even though the stakes are technically low, it wasn't the end of the world, you felt them a lot more. And I think the issue with all these big epic films, and this is definitely true of Thor the Dark World, is that they use the world's gonna end as a crutch to be like, oh, that's why you're so invested, that's why the stakes are so high, because the world's gonna end. But that's not what makes the stakes feel high to a viewership, to the audience. What makes them feel high is you connect with the characters that are concerned about the stakes, and you're worried about the characters. And so I had very little connection with most of the characters in Thor, because Thor is like his god, it's hard to sort of identify with him. And with Peter Parker, they did an amazing job. That's why, like, some people said they didn't think this film was all that great, because they don't like high school movies, or they thought that it meandered or was too boring. But I think that is what makes this movie great, is the fact that we spend so much time with Peter Parker and see him as an every day teenager in high school, and the stuff that he goes through, and you identify with him. I think that's brilliant character building. And as I said, like, the villain, what they did with Michael Keaton was amazing. He's hands down, I think he's the best villain of the MCU. Because he's the most well-rounded character. Like that, as I said, the opening scene, you feel for him. You feel like he's being screwed by the rich. They're just coming in here and they're just, they don't give a fuck that he already spent, invested all his money for this job that's a huge thing to him, that he could lose his house, his mortgage. They're like, nah, fuck off. You know, obviously they were maybe a bit heavy-handed with that, but it works. I mean, I think it's okay to have it heavy-handed because Keaton's the villain in this film. And so when you see him years later and he's actually doing well for himself, you feel relieved. You're like, oh, I'm so glad he didn't lose his house. I'm so glad he's able to provide for his family. And then you find out he's doing this through illegal weapons trades. And then that makes you step back. You're like, huh. Why, it makes you question yourself, why am I glad he's succeeding if he's actually the bad guy? And it's that complexity that makes villains good. I'm sorry, but it is. And even throughout the film, like, you do want him to be defeated by Spider-Man, because, as I said, the film does such a great job of developing and making you identify with Peter Parker and feel his plight. And, you know, ultimately, this guy is selling weapons to criminals that could kill people. And this is demonstrated with the bank robbers, how they, like, destroyed that deli across the street. And they could have really killed some people, and it's a result of what Michael Keaton's character is doing. And so you see that he's the villain and he needs to be stopped, but you still can sympathize with him. And that's what makes it so great. And some people complain about the Spider-Man suit being too much like Iron Man suit, and I'm like, fuck off. I don't care. It works for the story. It's funny. It helps develop the character, so I don't care. Oh, it's too much like Iron Man. It's not like Spider-Man. Oh, it's too much the MCU. Hey, go away with that crap. All I care about, does it work for the characters? Does it work for the story? Does it make it an entertaining movie? And the answer to all those questions is yes. So I don't give a shit if it's too much like Iron Man. It's actually way better than any of the other Spider-Man movies. And his interactions with his best friend, I think his name is Ned, who's wasn't a comic book character, so some people might get up in arms like, oh, he's not a comic book character. Who cares? Because it works for the story and it helps flesh out the world. I think this movie was brilliantly written. This is a very well structured, very well written movie. But now I gotta talk about the scene in the car where we find out that Michael Keaton is Liz's father. Liz, of course, is the crush. You know, Peter Parker has a crush on her throughout the whole film. And that scene where Peter Parker goes and rings the doorbell, and they have, this is played up so beautifully. This is such good writing, because this is after Peter Parker had his little lows and Iron Man took back the suit, and he was like, oh, I'm screwed, so I should just forget the whole thing. I should just go back and go to school and do my thing. And he actually asked the girl out for the date and got the date, so things are looking up. And they're playing this, like, upbeat music montage, and, like, everything's going well. He's going to pick up the girl, rings the doorbell, and boom, the music stops immediately. Michael Keaton opens the door, and he's just like, you kind of feel, you have that feeling of shock that mirrors Peter Parker. I did not see this coming. And I know that some people might say, oh, this is a bit serendipitous, a bit contrived, that Michael Keaton, you know, the villain, just so happens to be the father of the girl he's dating. Maybe a little bit, but who cares? Because it works so well. And it's so effective. Like, when the moment, like, he opens that door, and he's just like, I think it is definitely one of the most effective, shocking moments, probably in any film. Probably in any film, because too many times, too many films rely too much on, oh, this is going to be shocking, and it actually would have been better if they had revealed it earlier, because you have to do what's best for the story, not to try to elicit a shock. But Eliciting this shock is actually excellent for the story. It works so well into putting you in the mindset of Peter Parker. And that whole time, like when he's in Liz's house waiting for her, like this is such good acting on Tom Holland's part. How he's so distracted, he couldn't. He's like, "Oh, here's your corset," and he's just staring at Michael Keaton, because he of course recognizes him as the Vulture, as the main villain who's doing these things, and he's awestruck by this. And of course, Michael Keaton doesn't realize this at first, but then when they're in that car scene, I'm not finished my rewatch of the whole MCU, but I'm pretty sure I won't change my mind about this. This scene in the car with Michael Keaton driving, and he starts to realize that Peter Parker is Spider-Man, is the single best scene in the entire MCU. This scene gave me goosebumps, even though I've seen it several times before. It's just such a great scene. I mean, the act, like, Michael Keaton is brilliant in this role. He's a brilliant actor. Does anyone deny that? They shouldn't deny that. And Tom Holland also plays it off great. But the way they reveal that he slowly starts to, and you can see it in his face as he slowly starts to put the pieces together, and Tom Holland is trying to, like, avoid Liz's questions because he can tell that it's making it clear that he's, you know, Spider-Man. He's trying to avoid that because he knows who Michael Keaton is. But as soon as he figures that out, I'm like, that was absolutely brilliant. And he was like, stopped at a traffic light, and he wouldn't go even though it turned green. And like, oh, why don't you go? Signifying how that sort of light bulb is affecting him just as much. And he talks to Peter alone in the car after Liz goes in, and he's like, he was so menacing and threatening. And here's the thing, is that he's, as I said, this is like a bottom tier villain as far as like threatening villains go. Like, he's not going to destroy the world like Malekith, whatever the hell his name is, and he's not like going to unleash an unstoppable demon who's going to conquer the whole world or whatever, like in Doctor Strange. So he's kind of like a bottom tier villain, but he's still menacing in this context of the film, because the context of the film is this, the world of this teenage boy, and he is kind of a challenge to Spider-Man. I mean, so much so that Iron Man tells him to leave it alone. He wants other people like the FBI to handle it, even though he admitted that he's kind of below the radar as far as the Avengers are concerned. He's still above the pay grade of what Spider-Man is capable of. And you can tell that it was a huge challenge for him. So he felt, you could feel that tension. You could feel how threatened that Peter Parker felt in that moment. And it was just so brilliant the way he was like, "I just saved your life. Are you gonna thank me for that?" And he's like, "Thank you." I was like, "Oh my god, that scene was so good." Not only do I think it's the best scene in the MCU, I think it's one of the best scenes in any film ever. I'm gonna throw that out there. You know, it's funny because after I saw, and I'll cover Spider-Man Far From Home in the next video, but after I saw Far From Home, I've heard a couple people say that they thought it was better than Homecoming. And I thought, yeah, Far From Home was good, but did Far From Home have a scene with Michael Keaton in the car where he figured out who Peter Parker was and was threatening? No, it did not. Therefore, it is by default not better. I'm sorry, but it's not. That scene was so amazing. And then the triumph of Peter Parker, like, going, like, in the air, he no longer has this suit, so he flew up, like, with the Vulture to this airplane, where you could feel the tension, you could feel the danger, unlike Guardians of the Galaxy 2, where Drax can just smack into trees and be like, "I'm fine." Here, you felt like he could easily die. And this was he no longer had the parachute, he no longer had the balancing act, he just had a crummy suit. He was up there with these wings, and you could see when he tried to use them normally, since the plane was going so high speeds, the web's just like almost useless. And it was, I would say, one of the most high tension third acts. This is by far much better than the stereotypical third act where you have a sky beam or a faceless army, or you have a superhero fighting a villain that has the same powers as the superhero, and they just go boo, boo. Like I talked about in The Incredible Hulk, I was bored during the third act. I feel no tension. Here, there was no huge action set piece. It was just Spider-Man only hanging from an airplane. But that was like, the tension was like up to 11. It was like a billion times more effective. And part of that had to do with how the fact that I related to the characters so much, that I cared about these characters, and that I felt the danger that Peter Parker was in. And also, like, normally I hate the cliche of a superhero saving the villain's life and being like, no, I will not kill. This is done very badly in some examples, and I talked about this in some examples. But here, I loved it. Here it made total sense, especially because even Peter Parker could relate. Because as an audience, we too could relate to Michael Keaton's character. He's a father trying to do what's best for his family. He's just lost his way, but his heart was in the good place. And you feel for him because he's been screwed by the system. And Peter Parker goes out of his way to save his life. And I could not buy that more. I could not buy it more. It was so. This movie is just so well written. It's so well done. I did underestimate it before I rewatched it, just how amazing this film is. So, my rating for Spider-Man Homecoming out of 10 is a 9. Excellent. I was very close to giving this movie a 10, to be honest, but I don't think it quite comes up to 10 material because it does meander a little bit in the middle of the film. But it's close to it. Close to a 10. I'd probably give it a 9.5 if I did 0.5s, but I don't. So, yes, my rating for Spider-Man Homecoming is a 9. So, let's move on over to the next film, which is Thor Ragnarok. Now, last time I did this video with a few other YouTubers where we all ranked all the MCU movies from worst to best, or our favorite, or least favorite to our favorite, I had Thor Ragnarok as number one, as my favorite movie of the MCU. Now, I'm not sure if that will still be the case. I think it actually might not be. And this is another film I rewatched relatively recently. I would say I rewatched this one a year ago. I think this film came out 2 years ago, if I remember correctly, and I rewatched it like a year ago, so somewhat fresh in my mind. And I guess part of the reason why I love this movie so much, I mean, those who are familiar with my channel know I lived in New Zealand for 15 years, and so I watched a lot of New Zealand. I'm aware of the culture, and I watched a lot of New Zealand films. And Taika Waititi, sorry if I mispronounced that, I should know better, but he is a well-known New Zealand director, and I saw several of his films before I saw Thor Ragnarok, so I was already well aware of him. Like, one of my favorite films he did was a film called Eagle vs. Shark, which actually most people who like him don't, that's not high on his radar. Most people just think that film's average. I thought it was hilarious. It was kind of like, I heard some critics describe it as a Napoleon Dynamite wannabe, but I'm sorry. And I almost did a video about this because I feel so strong about this. That movie is way better than Napoleon Dynamite. I saw it first, and once I saw Napoleon Dynamite, I was like, this is just doing what Eagle vs. Shark did, but a lot worse, and not nearly as funny. I'm sorry, I love, but most people, when they ask, oh, what's your favorite Taika Waititi movie, I will say Eagle vs. Shark, and they're like, really? They're taken aback. Because most people like Boy, and I gotta be honest, I haven't actually seen Boy. I should really see Boy, but I don't know, the premise of it didn't look that interesting to me, but Boy is probably, I think at one stage it was the highest grossing New Zealand film. And I'm talking about New Zealand domestic made and funded films, so Lord of the Rings doesn't count because obviously that would blow anything out of the water. But that's considered an American film that was filmed in New Zealand because it was funded with American money. So just to clarify. But just, if you're talking about New Zealand funded films, then Boy, I think, was the one that made the most money, was the most popular. And I haven't seen it. Sorry. Maybe I know I should see it. But a couple of other, like, he did Hunt for the Wilder People, which I think was after Thor Ragnarok, if I remember correctly. And I thought it was okay, but I didn't think it was all that great. I thought it was maybe a bit too silly over the top for me. Oh, and he did, of course, What We Do in the Shadows, which is probably what... I think it was a film he did right before this one. It was probably the one that put him most on Hollywood's radar, because a lot of the Hollywood, the American critics loved it. And it was more, seen more as like an indie movie, so not everyone heard of it, of course. But, you know, it's a mockumentary about vampires living in, like, flats in Wellington, which is where I lived when I was in New Zealand. So, and it was filmed in Wellington, so watching it was cool because I recognized all the places. I actually knew a few people who were in the film. There was one of the actors who played like the zombie guy. I had actually worked with him on a short film. Well, he was the actor. I was just doing continuity. But it was weird seeing him in this film. And I was surprised how much I liked What We Do in the Shadows, because I don't like vampire movies and I don't like mockumentaries. So I didn't actually see this for a long time because I didn't think I'd like it. But I actually liked it. I maybe wouldn't praise it as much as some people do and say it was the funniest movie ever. But I did... it was really funny. So, I know I'm probably going off topic, but I just wanted to give you the background that this is what I was already aware of when I came into Thor Ragnarok. And, of course, it was a huge deal in New Zealand when it was announced that Taika Waititi was going to direct a MCU big-budget Marvel film, because that was a huge deal. And so I was very anticipating seeing this film, and then when the trailers came out for it, because... at this stage, as you probably know, I didn't think much of Thor in his movies because I thought the first two were average and I didn't give a crap about it. So I was, when they first announced there was going to be another third Thor movie, I could care less. I did not give a shit. But when they announced that Taika Waititi was directing, that changed everything. I was like, wow, they're actually going in this new direction. I really want to see what he does with a big budget Hollywood movie. And once the trailer started dropping, I was like, wow, this looks amazing. So I went and I saw it, and I remember I loved the shit out of it. That it was even better than I thought it would be. In fact, I might even go as far to say that this was Taika Waititi's best movie. That he could do, once he had this big Hollywood budget, which he'd never had before, usually just made these smaller indie films, mostly just New Zealand films. And what he could do with this huge budget was amazing. And it's not just that it was because he's, you know, directed mostly comedies, but the fact that the action sequences and the way this film was shot, I think was absolutely beautiful. Probably the most beautifully shot film of the entire MCU. So that, I remember, that blew me away. And I was absolutely in love with it, so I called it the best MCU movie. So, and I have friends, too, in New Zealand who feel the same way, that they feel that this movie, hands down, is the best. And a lot of people I talk to in New Zealand feel this way, but maybe it's a national thing. But hands down, this is the best movie in the MCU. But let me go watch it, and I'll come back and see if I still feel the same. Alright, so just watched Thor Ragnarok, and I have to say, I was really impressed with the movie. I still think it's a great movie, but I'm almost pretty sure that this will not be the best on my list, or I would not call it the best movie of the MCU anymore. It's still top tier for me, don't get me wrong. But I wasn't like quite as like enthralled and thought that it was like one of the most amazing things. Like after watching the MCU all in a row up to this point, I do think movies like Captain America: Winter Soldier might consider that better, or Endgame. But I'll see how I feel with that in the rewatch, and even Homecoming is kind of a close call between this and Homecoming for me. So I still love this movie. I just probably will say that I won't call it the best movie of the MCU anymore. Now, I still think it's way better than a lot of people give it credit for, particularly a lot of critics. A lot of critics, I think, were too harsh on this film and thought it was just kind of mediocre. And, like, the most common complaint I heard was that it's the comedy interfered with the dramatic effect, with the drama in it, and that it sometimes actually underscored the emotional impact that the action sequences or the drama sequences had. And I say that's just a bunch of bollocks. That's just a bunch of hooey, as they say. It's BS. It's nonsense. I completely disagree with that. I could not disagree with that more. In fact, I would go as far to say that this is the best movie in the MCU to blend the comedy in with the action elements. I think this has the best comedy out of any MCU movie, including Homecoming. Although Homecoming did a great job of blending these two elements together too, but I think is definitely more prominent. Now, here's the thing. After having watched Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, that movie, the comedy did actively interfere with the drama. And that movie, the comedy was way too over the top. It was too invasive. But it's not at all the case here. And I think the people who say that are completely crazy. Because especially after rewatching it, I was taken aback on how little the comedy was and how I was expecting it to be more over the top, particularly after what all these critics were saying about it. And after watching it, I was like, actually, Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 was like almost at least 10 times worse. That, especially watching these both together in a short period of time, like that movie, the comedy was way invasive, where here, like, I think it was perfect. I think it was a perfect blend. Now, one example some critics I've heard given was at the end of the movie when Asgard is like being destroyed and Korg is on the ship and he's like, oh, this, you know, you can still rebuild and this will be a haven for all weary travelers to go through, and then the planet like destroys, you know, explodes and is completely destroyed, and he's like, oh, never mind, you can't rebuild that. I've heard people complain that undercuts the moment of Asgard being destroyed with this silly comedy. And here's what I say. This moment was given its due. Because at this point, we already knew Asgard was going to be destroyed. It's not a shock when it blew up, if you were paying any freaking attention to the movie. So this was actually given its due earlier, when Thor was talking to Odin. Odin was saying that Asgard was not a place, it's a people, and then this sentiment is repeated with Heimdall shortly thereafter, and I think the moment was really given its due when Thor says this to Valkyrie, when that they have to let Asgard be destroyed. That's when it really had a dramatic impact, and I think the film did give it the drama that was due. So at this stage, the movie already sufficiently had let, you know, this moment have the dramatic impact. So at this point, I think it was the perfect time to add in comedy. And for the record, I think that was a very funny joke and I liked it. I remember when I first saw that movie, I thought that was hilarious when Korg was like, oh, never mind. It's just, it goes so perfectly with the silliness of his character. And plus, Korg is such a, he's like, I would probably go as far as to say that he is the best comedic character in all of the MCU. Definitely better than Drax. Although Rocket is a close step, but Rocket can be a bit annoying at times. I think Korg's better. I think Korg is the best comedic character in the MCU. Played by the director Taika Waititi, who does a great job. And of course, he purposely played Korg with the strong rural New Zealand accent, which I thought was kind of, I like that. Having lived in New Zealand, it was interesting to see a New Zealand character in the MCU, even though, you know, accent anyway. And I didn't realize that the rock creatures were actually shown in the Dark World. Even when I rewatched Dark World recently, it wasn't until I watched a YouTube video pointed out that Korg is supposed to be the same alien species that we saw at the beginning of Dark World when Thor and the Warriors 3, and don't worry, I'll get to them soon, when they went to some world at the very start of the film to put down an insurrection, which was, you know, insignificant to the plot, and Thor had to square off against the rock creature. I had no idea that was actually the same species as Korg. But anyway, so I actually think that the comedy in this film was perfect, and I don't think it interfered with the drama. The only scene I will say that the comedy felt a bit too over the top and kind of took me out of it was the opening scene, even though I did think this was hilarious. But the opening scene where Thor was spinning around in the chain and the monster was like monologuing, and it's like, "I will destroy Asgard," and Thor's like, "Wait, hold on, I gotta spin." Like, I thought that was hilarious, but that did seem more like a parody comedy movie than actually fitting into this action movie. And it does seem like, it almost seems to me like that was Taika Waititi, or at least this film, making fun of the tone that the first two movies had. And I think that's well deserved to make fun of that tone, because as I said, particularly Dark World was way too up its own ass and trying to be like Lord of the Rings too much, and it just comes off a bit silly with these over the top villains going like, "I will destroy," and like the Malekith, it just comes off as bland. Well, here they purposely make the horn do whatever he's called. They purposely make him way over the top, and they make fun of them, and I think it works. And I think it fits at the end of the movie when he ends up actually being the one to destroy Asgard. Like, this is amazing. I think this all works. Now, other complaints I heard about this film is that it gets boring in the middle chunk of the movie when Thor's on that other world being, you know, with the tournament and Hulk is hanging out there, and they have I can't remember the name of that world, it's like a trash world or whatever, and they had the Jeff Goldblum being, what do they call him, the Grandmaster running the games. And watching it again, I do think that it does lull a bit. And maybe that's why, part of the reason why I wouldn't necessarily call this the best movie of the MCU. But I totally disagree with the sentiment that this was boring or that dragged on for too long. I mean, maybe a little bit. But actually, because some people might look at it as it's just a huge distraction, because the film's about Ragnarok happening on Asgard. So most of the action is about his... So the start of the film, Thor comes and finds out Loki's running Asgard, and then they go the Odin find is dead, and then Hela comes back and has a huge conflict, and then he's vanished to this alien trash planet, and so he spends most of the film trying to get back to Asgard, and then he finally gets back to Asgard, and that's when the film picks up again, because it's about him retaking Asgard. So if you look at it that way, all that time spent in the middle on this trash planet was a waste of time, because it was all about trying to stop Hela from taking over Asgard. But I think that I would argue that that is the incorrect way to look at this film. I would look at this film more as a character story of Thor trying to grapple with the realities of Ragnarok coming and things changing, such as, it's actually a nice metaphor for dealing with the death of a parent, because that's basically what he's having to do in this film. So the time we spend on the trash heap planet is not a waste of time, because it's great character development, because it's all about Thor coming to terms with trying to accept a new reality that he doesn't want to accept, and so it leads him to the experiences that he had on the trash planet leads him to change his character and come to the conclusion to let Asgard be destroyed and to save the people. That's something that he wouldn't be able to do before. Also, it helps him find his own self-worth, because his hammer was destroyed, and I've heard some people complain about that too. Oh, what's a Thor movie without his hammer? Which is, get over it, geeks. I actually think it worked. But it was a good character story for Thor to have to realize that his real true power comes within as well, because he's at first he's like helpless, he's like, he's just whining, oh, I'm the Lord of God of Thunder, and the Grandmaster just makes fun of him and calls him Lord of Thunder, and he can just shock him all the time. And again, the way this was done humorously, perfect, I think. I love the perfect blend of humor and action and drama in this movie. I think they got it perfect. Absolutely perfect. I would say argue even better than the first Guardians of the Galaxy. Definitely way better than the second one. I think that they got the balance way off there, in my opinion. But, and so I actually, even though I will say, for most of that sequence on the trash planet, I was just like, come on, Thor, get off the planet. Come on, hurry up and get off the planet. I do think it does work and building this character. And plus, I love the way they incorporated Hulk as well. I mean, of course, it's a bit serendipitous that Hulk just happens to be there. But then again, they kind of imply that there's a lot of portals, because they have all these black holes or portals or whatever, so most people who end up lost end up just getting dumped on this planet, so it's not that serendipitous, so I buy it. But anyway, and it was an interesting character journey for Hulk as well, particularly the carry off of like Bruce Banner. When he finally reemerges, he thinks he's still in Age of Ultron, because that's the last time he was there, and he has to come to terms with the fact that 2 years passed, and he's terrified that if he never turns in, if he turns into Hulk again, he'll never come back. And just a little spoiler for an Infinity War, it actually turns out that even after he does come back, Bruce Banner does come back. In fact, he has a hard time convincing Hulk to come back, so he's actually stuck as Bruce Banner for a while, which is interesting. And of course, the resolution to that problem in the Endgame is interesting, but of course, I'll cover that in the next video. But that was a really interesting character story for him as well. And in fact, I love the bromance between Hulk and Thor. I don't think these scenes were a waste of time. I think they're great character building scenes for both of them. Like how Hulk was all frustrated and started throwing shit around and almost hit Thor, and Thor was like calling him the stupid Avenger or whatever. Like, it was a good like a buddy cop movie. It was a good, because we've seen the Avengers before, but it's great to sort of hyper-focus on the relationship between two in particular. Particularly Thor and Hulk, which are both sort of the muscle of the Avengers. So I think that was a great team up. And I love seeing them team up on Asgard to fight Hela. Now, as I alluded to in my preamble, the fight sequences on Asgard at the end, especially when they use the Led Zeppelin music, probably my favorite fight scenes in the entire MCU. I'll just lay this out. And in fact, I probably go as far to say, although maybe Endgame will change my mind, but as far, at least how where we're up to so far, I would say this is the best third act of any movie had in the MCU. Even, I'll put it maybe slightly ahead of Homecoming, although it is a close call. But yeah, I would say this, this even better than Winter Soldier, this is the best third act of a film, because the third act was amazing. The fight choreography, and this is where I give all due credit to Taika Waititi, because, I studied New Zealand and filmmaking in New Zealand, and I can say the type of filmmaking that they usually like to make is really indie films that's focused on cinematography and like art house and having beautiful shots. In fact, I would argue they focus on this too much, and usually to the detriment of the storytelling. But if you have that, I could tell that he was trained in that sort of manner, even though I know he wasn't the cinematographer, but I would imagine he worked closely with the cinematographer, and the cinematographer is probably well trained in that as well, that they blend that visual, sense of having this beautiful photography with action sequences in a way I've rarely seen movies do. And not just the visual, but the audio as well. As I said, the music, the Led Zeppelin music they play along to it with, that goes blend so smooth, so seamlessly with the, you know, how they had the slow motion and they speed it up and they make it like blend seamlessly into such a beautiful, like, it looked, the way it's shot is just so amazing, so well done. I would say this is definitely the best fight scene in the MCU, at least so far. Even I might like Endgame one better for different reasons, but as far as like craft of it goes, I would probably stick behind this one. Yeah, it was absolutely amazing, and probably the most beautiful shot in the film though is when Loki makes Valkyrie remember the moment where all the Valkyrie attacked Hela and Lawson, they all got killed except for her. That shot was fucking amazing. That was absolutely beautiful. I mean, I've rarely seen movies with such like art put into it, and especially this is a comic book movie. This is an MCU movie. Yeah, it was so artful. It was so powerful. And not only is it an MCU movie, it's mostly a comedy one, but it's done so well. Plus, I fucking love Valkyrie's character as well, the way she was drunk all the time. That was funny. And of course, you gotta love Jeff Goldblum. I mean, only crazy people don't love Jeff Goldblum. And I think the way he was used in this film was great, too. And also, I gotta correct myself from the preamble, because I said that I thought Hunt for the Wilder People came out after this film, but then I realized it actually came out before this film, because the actress who was in Hunt for the Wilder People played Jeff Goldblum's like second in command, who's all like thirsty and wanting to kill people. And I remember when I first saw that movie, I was like, oh, that's the lady from Hunt for the Wilder People. So I'd obviously, and I saw this in the theaters when it first came out, so obviously Hunt for the Wilder People came out before this one. But and she was great too. And that role, how she kept trying to get him to kill people. That was funny. And also when they're having the spaceship flight, you know, chase scene, and I think someone, Valkyrie probably revealed that the ship they're on, it was a Grandmaster uses it for orgy. And they're like, oh, there must be buttons. What does this thing do? They press it and like a disco ball comes down. That's funny. That is good use of comedy that flows with the action, not interferes with it. I do think this movie is really great. Before I go, I guess I gotta talk about the Warriors 3, because I mentioned them in the two previous Thor movies. People were pissed off that they just killed them off and Thor didn't care. First of all, Thor's got bigger things in his mind to worry about than the Warriors 3, right? The entire Asgard is at risk of being, and in fact the planet itself is destroyed, and he has to save who he can save. So what do you expect him to do? Be like, oh no, the Warriors 3, oh by the way, Asgard's being destroyed. No, I think this complaint's stupid. And secondly, nobody cares about the Warriors 3, except for people who've read comic books and like, I want to see more of the Warriors 3. Any movie-going audience, you just judge these movies on their throwaway character. Even the first two movies, they're just generic throwaway characters. Some people might complain that the first two were killed off really quickly, and okay, maybe I can see that. But the third dude, and I don't even know their names, it's not worth remembering, but the third dude, they did give a long, drawn-out, a proper death to, because he stood up to Hela, and I think that's all you need. Now, they didn't have Lady Sith in this movie. They did name drop her during that play, but and apparently it's because they couldn't get the actress to do it because she was busy doing other stuff, and maybe that's a good thing, because they probably just would have killed her off. So I think I mentioned this before, but there's rumors she might appear later, and I hope she does, because she is a dangling thread. I think it would make a lot of sense if they did. I do hope that they actually show her later on, even if she doesn't play that big of a role. Now, as far as some people complained that they resolved the thing with Loki too quickly, because there was a huge cliffhanger at the end of Dark World that Loki was pretending to be Odin, but I also say pish-posh to that, because first of all, I didn't like that cliffhanger, and I was like, oh god, when they revealed it. So I was actually really thrilled that they kind of just sped through that, and I actually think they did pay. It's not like they just like wipe it aside. I was like, that never happened, whatever. They did actually, in my opinion, pay proper service to that, because it led into the whole fact of Odin dying eventually. That he, and I like how, you know, Loki just dropped him out of the nursing home and kind of wiped his mind, but eventually he overcame that spell, but decided to stay on Earth in Norway and eventually passed away. And this has built up resentment in Thor, that he actually, you know, was resenting Loki because he kind of blamed him part for their father's death. So that's great. I don't think they wiped it clean or not, but I think they paid a significant service. Like, what do you want the whole movie to be about that? Fuck no. You're crazy. No. So I think what they did was perfect. Now, as far as Loki, I like what they did with him in this movie too. I think they significantly used Loki in a good way. I thought the scenes with him when he first saw the Hulk was hilarious, and when he was like freaking out, and then when the Hulk like beat the shit out of Thor, he's like, "No, you know how it feels." Like, that's a good callback. And again, I like the way they use him. How he, you know, was going to trick Thor and betray him, but Thor, of course, knew this because it's like, I know you too well. It's like, it was a perfect relationship, and then he actually does show up at Ragnar, at Asgard at the end, and it's like, I'm your savior! Like, this is the best use of Loki. And of course, he is still up to his own tricks, even though at the end of the movie, Thor thinks they're all on the level, but really, he stole the Tesseract from the, you know, Asgard without telling anyone, which, of course, if they... I don't know, because if they would have left it there, it probably wouldn't be destroyed, because I think it's a lot harder to destroy an Infinity Stone, so I think it would have survived the destruction of Asgard. But it would have... So, that's the case, and Thanos could have just cruised on by and picked it up from there, and not having to attack all the Asgardians. But, you know, I'll cover this more when I get to Infinity War, but a lot of people were assuming that the Asgard really, that Thor, Thanos came and killed off all the Asgard, and it kind of undercut the point of this film, was Asgard was the people, not the place. But I think it's implied, and I'll have to watch this in Infinity War again, that all the Asgard evacuated and a few people stayed behind on the ship to fight off Thanos, and those people, like Heimdall, died, but the majority got away. And this, of course, supported an endgame where you see a whole Asgardian colony in Norway. So obviously, a lot of them, including Valkyrie, I said a lot of them survived and got away, which is just my opinion, or not my opinion, that's my guess. But anyway, my rating for Thor Ragnarok out of 10 is a 9. Excellent. I think this is an excellent film. It was well crafted, well made, some beautiful shots. I think they blended the comedy and the action perfectly. No matter what those critics say, they're wrong. Perfect blend of comedy, action, and drama, in my opinion. But I can see the point of view that it did drag a bit in the middle, but for me, it didn't drag too much. It didn't drag enough for me to say it actively hurt the film. Maybe it kept it from being truly great, but I still think those scenes on that plane were not a waste of time, because it was a strong character story throughout the whole film, and those kind of served the purpose of Thor's character story. Anyway, let's move on to the last movie of this video, and that is Black Panther. So, I don't know how I feel. It was hard for me. I'm still not sure how I feel about this movie. I would say it's probably a bit overrated, because it's lauded by many to be one of the best of the MCU. It like made one of the most, some of the most money of any, and it was nominated for Best Picture. Honestly, I think that was an attempt for the Oscars to try to attract more audience to watch the Oscars, because they've been losing audiences like crazy. I don't think it deserves to get nominated for Best Picture. From memory, maybe I'll change my mind after I watch it, but I don't think so. And I just think it's a bit... You know how I talk about a lot of the MCU movies are not very well structured, and the plot's all over the place? From memory, this is one of those. And it didn't really feel much like a superhero movie. It felt more like this is the nation of Wakanda. And it wasn't, even though it was called Black Panther, it seemed like he wasn't in it that much. And all the supporting characters got more screen time than he did. But, yeah, maybe not. I don't know. So, I'm going to go watch old Black Panther and come back and let you know what I think after the rewatch. Alright, so I just come back from watching Black Panther, and I think I was wrong, actually. I think when I said in the preamble that I thought that this would be a disjointed, not a very well-structured plot, I think that I was wrong. I think it actually was fairly well-constructed. I think it wasn't as good as some movies like Spider-Man Homecoming or Doctor Strange, but it was certainly better than a lot of these other MCU movies like The Incredible Hulk or Iron Man 2 and Avengers Age of Ultron. So it was fairly decent as far as a well-structured plot. I think I did really enjoy this movie a lot. I think it hits some things like so right. And of course you can't ignore like the cultural phenomenon, like zeitgeist this film was, because it featured almost entirely black actors. I don't want to say African-American because not all were American. Some were actually from Africa, but it featured almost entirely a cast of black actors, and from what I understand, behind the camera was mostly black people working on the film, as well as done by a black director. And so to have this done in a mainstream comic book huge super blockbuster, I think is unprecedented. Like, there's of course a lot of niche movies that do this, but they're seen as sort of more of the black movies, whereas this was like a mainstream movie for everyone. It was a cultural, it was like a huge blockbuster. It was one of the highest grossing films of all time. In fact, I think it's because of this. So that's something that can't be denied. But you do have to judge this movie on its own merits. That's what I'm always saying, that I always like to judge movie on its own merits. I think it's unfair for anyone who criticizes this movie to be seen through that lens, oh, you don't dislike it because it's black. No, that's not true. You have to judge it on its own merit. So I try not to let that fact influence whether or not I actually like the film and judge it on its own merits. But I do have to acknowledge that, and that is actually a very positive thing. But I do actually like this film on its own merits, but I think it has some issues. It's not perfect, I would say. I stand behind my statement that it's not deserving to be nominated for Best Picture. God, if I was going to choose a comic book movie from the MCU that so far that deserved to be nominated for Best Picture, I think it would go with Spider-Man Homecoming, to be honest. I think that would probably be my first pick. Outside of the MCU, I'd say Logan, hands down. It was actually a travesty that Patrick Stewart didn't get nominated for Best Supporting Actor. That was a travesty. But not Black Panther. Just my opinion. But it's still a really good movie. I still really did enjoy it. I think I do stand by my statements that it feels like the movie's called Black Panther, but it feels like I don't get a strong sense of that character, and that the movie's not really about him. It's more of about the political situation in Wakanda. And so it doesn't really, I wouldn't even call it like a superhero movie, because it doesn't feel like a superhero movie. It feels like a movie about Wakanda, like a political coup, which is basically what it's about. The first half of the movie does have that more of the superhero, the Marvel feel to it, because, as you know, you have Black Panther going to Korea, climbing on top of cars, chasing after Claw with Andy Serkis going, yeah, and hamming it up and shooting it. That part of it did feel like a superhero movie. But that, we learned that part of it was really just a preamble for, it was setting the stage for Killmonger, I know his name now, watch the film, for Killmonger's plan to take the throne in Wakanda. So these were just steps in the plan that actually, unlike Zemo's, works and makes sense. Sorry, I'm not going to drop that. Anyway, that I actually find totally believable. Anyway, so even those superhero elements in the first half of the film I would say overall, because then the second half of the film, we get into it just becomes about a coup in Wakanda. So it becomes about the internal politics in Wakanda. And so the movie's really more like that. Not that there's anything wrong with that, because I praise a lot of these MCU movies for stepping outside of the superhero box. Like Winter Soldier with becoming more of a political thriller, Guardians of the Galaxy being more of a space opera, or, stuff like that. So, I have nothing wrong with it. It's just when people say, oh, this is the first black superhero movie, I kind of think, well, is it really a superhero movie, though? But I suppose that I'm just splitting hairs at that point. Major black. People bring up Blade, but again, I never see Blade as a superhero movie. That was a horror movie. That was a horror action movie. It just happened to be based off a comic book. My opinion, I know Blade's coming to the MCU, so he will then officially be considered a super, but I just never looked at Blade as a superhero. Just me. He was like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, or what other like horror action stars you had, like Ripley from Aliens. Is she a superhero? I don't know. She didn't have powers. But anyway, I'm getting off topic. So this was a I did like the film a lot. I do feel like it was a bit lacking in the character stories, which, if you know me, that's a stronger component. There were some strong elements of character story. Don't get me wrong, particularly the scenes with T'Challa and seeing his dead father, and like when he gets the powers. Now, I love the symmetry of when Killmonger becomes king and he gets the powers, that he has a vision of his father. And I love that scene so much, because it really humanizes this character. And I don't know. I'll have to see how I feel after I finish watching everything. But I think I would put Killmonger as my second favorite villain of the MCU, behind, of course, the Vulture. He was definitely another one who, like the Vulture, was extremely humanized. And you could see his perspective and his point of view. And I think the movie did a damn good job. And I like the contrast of that, of showing how he grew up in a poor neighborhood in Oakland, whereas, T'Challa was raised in royalty and wealth in Wakanda, and that the Wakanda was kind of hoarding this wealth. And so you sympathize with Killmonger. I do love the way that the film ultimately says that Killmonger was kind of right, but he was going about it the wrong way. The way that he was going about it, which was caused by the traumatic life that he led, and it caused him he, of course, joined the army and the Marines and became this cold-blooded killer. And so it led him down astray, as they say. So his version of like just arming everyone, are mostly those in black communities, that was not the solution. That would just make things worse. It would cause war on a global scale. And so the film's saying that T'Challa was influenced, though, by Killmonger and by realizing what his father did, and his father was wrong to kill his own brother. And it shows how strong in character that he is, that he didn't just dismiss Killmonger out of hand as an insane lunatic, that he could see his point of view and wanted to love him as a brother or cousin. They were cousins. But he wanted to love him as family. And but Killmonger was just not in that headspace, and he was more of, and he never really came, and in that regard, he did not come off as a two-dimensional villain. He came off as a dynamic where you could understand his perspective and understand where he was wrong and why he needed to be stopped, but still see where he was coming from. And I love that, and I think that was really well done. There are some plot holes or some issues I have with the film, though, because in the earlier part, he does come off too much as a stereotypical bad guy, I think, particularly that scene with the museum where he poisons the woman, just heartlessly shoots everyone, and then he like kills his own girlfriend just so he can get the claw. And so that doesn't really, I mean, it does, you could say that's input into the fact that he became this cold-blooded killer, but I think, I don't know. They sometimes when they try to make him sympathetic, even though I still really love those scenes, I think it does feel a tad bit forced. But and then you get the like the whole thing about him, his plan is still not as bad as Zemo, but the fact that he worked with Claw and then all of a sudden just decided to kill him and then present him to that other dude from Get Out. I can't remember his character's name. They presented to him, and so he gets his ally in Wakanda that he was very helpful in him taking the crown. But if that was his plan all along, why did he wait to kill Claw?
So when Killmonger shows up and says, "Oh, I killed Claw, I'm so great and awesome, love me, and I did what T'Challa couldn't do because he was lame."
Why didn't T'Challa point out that I actually did have Claw, but this guy came and stole him from me? So I was going to present him to you, but he just came and set him free so he could do it. Why didn't he bring that up? I don't know. And here's another thing that kind of holds me back a little on saying that this film was like a masterpiece. I don't know how I feel about the whole Wakanda thing. It's a bit, as I talked a bit before about stretching a suspension of disbelief, and I think this really stretches my abilities. I mean, you may say I'm being silly because there's a lot of other space, you know, stuff and crazy stuff that happened in the MCU, wizards who can teleport and shit. So why am I so making such a big deal out about Wakanda? But I don't know. It's a huge technological city that has the technology that's far more advanced than anything we have in present day, and they were hiding behind a shield the whole time. I don't know. It's just, to me, that just, I don't know. That's really too hard to accept. And I think someone else pointed out in another video, is like, what, you know, they were always more advanced than the rest of the world, but they didn't always have this technology to be invisible. So what did they do before they had that technology? How come they weren't discovered then? I don't know. But another, and then there's another, I think I saw another couple articles or videos that do question if this does actually do a disservice for the issues Africa has, because many African nations are resource poor. Or not, they're actually resource rich, but that the ones that are more resource rich are the ones that have more social strife, more poverty, because that's when the foreign powers come and try to mine and take their resources, and it causes more social strife. And I wonder if, in these specific articles, wonder if presenting this, you know, clearly mythical fantasy that there's an African nation that just happens to have super technology, is kind of doing a disservice to the strifes that these resource-rich nations actually do face, because it's presenting this fantastical situation. Like, look, they're all good and well. They're living in this beautiful utopia, which isn't actually in the reality. And also, it does sort of frame. I know they do try to play off this with Killmonger, but still, it makes all the past Wakandan kings and their rulership cold-blooded monsters who just sit there on their hands while all the nations around them suffered all these atrocities when they could have done something about it. And I know the film does try to address that, but I don't think they do a good enough job, to be honest. And so that honestly, I know many people may disagree with me on this, and that's fine. You know, everyone has their own opinion. This is just, I can't help it. This is just the way I see it, and it does sort of hold the whole concept of Wakanda. I just find a bit too inconceivable to get that far behind. It takes me out of it. Of the reality of the MCU. And yes, I know I'm being ridiculous because of wizards who can teleport and spaceships and stuff, but I don't know. That's just the way I see it. So, my rating for Black Panther out of 10 is an 8. Extremely good. I did really enjoy this movie. I thought it had one of the strongest villains. I liked the character story that T'Challa goes through, although, as I said, I think he could have appeared more in the film. I still thought it was overall strong. It had a very strong setup and situation, like the political situation in Wakanda, I did find very interesting. Although, I will say the first part of the film was kind of just
a distraction to set up for this stuff. But yeah, I agree. It was definitely a film that I felt very strongly about. But I don't think, as I said, I don't think it's amazing. I don't think it's one of the best movies ever. I don't think it deserved to be nominated for Best Picture. But it was still a really good film. Okay, so that is it. I am now done with part one of my coverage of Phase 3. Now, I will say that Phase 3 will hands down be my favorite phase of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And that's a bit unfair because Phase 3 has like almost twice the amount of films as the first two phases. So, if I do cut Phase 3 in half and say that this, and I say this is Phase 3A and the next one will be Phase 3B, Phase 3A is still my favorite phase of the MCU. Well, I haven't seen B yet, but I'm pretty sure I'd still feel this way. Even though it had films I wasn't too crazy about, like Guardians of the Galaxy 2 and Captain America Civil War, it had more, like, because most of these phases, if you notice, I give most films a 7. And here, I didn't give any film a 7. They either got, two of them got 6s, but the rest got, well, Black Panther got an 8, and the rest got 9s. Which is much, much better than I've done for any other phase. Usually you have only 1 9 or 1 10, and that's about it. But here it was like, I think we had powerful film after powerful film after powerful film. Well, you know, the exceptions, of course, being Civil War, which could have been a powerful film, but they botched the ending, and Guardians of the Galaxy, that was just average, I'm sorry, Volume 2. But the rest of them were like top notch. This is the MCU at its best. I think this phase, this specific, you know, 3A, is what really got me into the MCU. As I said before, even in Phase 2, I started to get into it, but this is what completely sold me. As I said, I'm not, you know, completely crazy about it still, but I will go out of my way to see their movies and get Disney Plus. I can watch the shows that are coming out as well. So it does. They do have me hooked, and it was mainly this phase because you got Doctor Strange, which I thought was amazing. You got Spider-Man Homecoming, which I thought was amazing. You got Thor Ragnarok, which I thought was absolutely amazing. And then Black Panther, not bad either. Pretty decent. Pretty good. So I think this is definitely the strength of the MCU. I would say it's my favorite phase. Anyway, I will be back in about a month to cover the second half of Phase 3, so be sure to keep an eye out for that. Also, check out my channel as I do many more videos and other shows like Star Trek, The Expanse, Lost, and more, so be sure to subscribe so you can keep up with all that. Thanks a lot for watching.